Welcome to the pre-drive Amble First Baby Impala!
No, panic! Can't even reverse!
Is it the first Baby Impala? Was it a Stenbok? It's a Stenbok! Oh dear! I got so excited. Now, there's a reason we're sitting in this particular area. Apparently, Hosanna and Shongile were left here sometime this morning while Krula went out hunting. I wonder what that Stenbok's staring at. And there were some Impala around, so I thought, oh, maybe it was the first baby Impala. Now, when these little leopard cubs have been left by their mother, they could be up in a tree, they could be under a bush, they could be on top of a termite mound. I'm just gonna look very carefully around here. A little Stenbok's looking into these thickets over here. And there are some car tracks from this morning that go off here, so maybe this is where they were left. Where are you hiding, little leopards? Of course, there's always the possibility that Krula made a kill during the day and came back and fetched them. I didn't see any tracks. What just happened there? There we go. Look at that. We have found them. And they're watching Impala. Well, we've found one of them. Now, where's the other? I think the other just tried to chase a Stenbok. I just saw something dart through here. Let's just go have a quick look, see if we can see the other little troublemaker. That Stenbok did look to be staring quite intently into these little thickets here. Now, it could very easily be the other of the little cubs. Well, they're not so little anymore. And when they're left by themselves, they will often hunt. Now, an adult impala might be a bit big. Oh, that looks like little Shongile. Where's Hosanna, madam? There she is. Oh, such a pretty pose. I'm just gonna get on the game driver and let them know we found. So Krula hasn't been back if they're still here. Where's Hosanna? Rex coming. Oh, isn't she gorgeous? That's a very elegant pose, young lady. I keep looking behind us and around us. I'm trying to see where young Hosanna is. I haven't seen them in so long, they've grown so much. And stations located one of Krula's Mompimpans, lying up on a termite mound, Junction Treehouse and Shabam Road. I heard something behind us.
This program features live coverage of an African safari. and may include animal kills and carcasses. Viewer discretion is advised.
And welcome on another magical live safari experience where all kinds of wonderful African animals abound. This is Safari Live.
Ready.
Standing by.
Good afternoon to all of you watching around the world. My name is Jamie, and this afternoon I have the amazing Brian on camera with me. Brian, the woodland ninja thumb.
Oh, yes.
Is the woodland ninja thumb looking a little larger today?
Yep.
I think there's a little bit of growing going on. Must be something in the water. And for those of you that are just joining us, welcome on Juma Private Game Reserve in the Kruger National Park area of South Africa. So right up on the northeastern corner of our beautiful country. We're coming to you live, which means it's also interactive. So you can send through your questions on hashtag Safari Live on Twitter, or you can email through to questions@wildearth.tv. We've got all sorts of exciting things planned for you. James in the tent, entertaining as always, Brent out on drive, and of course the amazing Stefan Winterboer on foot. With our live safaris, you just never know what to expect. I'm starting to feel a slight absence of elephants in my life. So the plan for my afternoon sunset safari is to go off and see if we can't find some of them. And ever since we've had the rainfall that we have had, which is of course, which we're very grateful for, ever since we've had all of this rainfall, it seems that the elephants have deserted us. Luckily for us, not everything has deserted us, and we do have some spotted cats for you. Let's jump on board with Brent.
Well, welcome on today's sunset safari, and the information we received was correct. That is Shongile, the female cub of Queen Karula, the dominant female leopard. I'm sure Hassana, the male, is around here somewhere. But my name is Brent Leo Smith. I have VM Doornbuck on camera, and we're lucky enough to be with a little leopard. Now, they can be quite playful when mom's away, and I'm just wondering where the young male is. I think she keeps looking down to the north of us. So I think probably a good chance that young Hassana's there. And she's exquisitely beautiful, growing so quickly. It's been quite a while since I've spent some time with the cubs, so great to catch up. They've got so big. Oh, there we go. Is she off to go search for her brother? Or is she just sniffing her surrounds? Now, quite often, female leopards can leave their cubs for long extended periods. Oh, now she's smelling a bit of urine. Half a phlegm and grimace there. And as I said, they spend quite a lot of time away from mom. And quite often in these periods is when they make their first kill. It's normally a lizard or a bird or a dwarf mongoose. But this is where they hone their hunting skills. So hunting skills in the big cats, they're not really taught as that they are instinctive, so they're born with those skills. And in these periods stalking little creatures that they come upon while their mum's out hunting for dinner is where they perfect those skills. Where are you off to now, madam? And isn't that a pose we've seen her mother in many times? Feet up on the log, trying to get a better look of what's up ahead. She keeps staring to the north, and I'm pretty sure Hassan is there somewhere. And see, not starving, but could definitely use a bit of a meal. And that's what mom's up to at the moment. She's hunting. She was last seen near Philemon's Dip, quite close to quarantine, but much easier to find where she's left cubs and then wait for her to return than to track her. And Queen Krula is a notoriously difficult leopard to track. She changes direction all the time. Absolutely exquisite. Now remember, this is a live safari, so she's gonna disappear and we're gonna try keep up with her. So while we do that, let's go bid a good afternoon to a highly entertaining individual who's in the strangest office in the world.
It is not the strangest office in the world, everybody. It is the most wonderful office in the world. My name is James Hendry. Hello to you all and welcome on the Sunday Sunset Safari. This is a lot of S's on camera today. The inimitable hoppy virus brain. There he is. That is Gendre, everybody, and I know you've all missed him deeply. This is because he has, well, when he was on leave, he went diving in the water and picked some horrendous dread disease up in his sinuses. He's been laid low with a fever of well over 100 degrees for the last 4 days, but he stoically got out of bed. We dragged him over here, fed him some drugs, and now he's kind of sort of doing his job. If I go out of focus, well, it's his fault. Now, we have a couple of new things to show you sometime today. We'll get to these during the course of the drive. One of the things I just want to show you before we sort of kick off too much is something under the microscope, and we'll just go there now. Now, that, of course, is something very important to show you because of all the great animals of Africa, this is one of them. Well, it's kind of a vertebrate relative is the one that we're not allowed to show you. This, of course, is a rhino beetle. And there is its horn, and this is the only rhino that you're likely to see on Safari Live, unfortunately. And that is because it is... Sorry about that. We just have to work out our coordination again. That is because, of course, we do not show rhino on this show. In lieu of the rhino poaching epidemic, and we just don't want them to be seen at all. So now we have this beautiful rhino beetle here. Now it's a kind of dung beetle, everybody, and the dung beetle, there he is, he will eat sort of dung. He is a dung beetle, but he just happens to have a very impressive horn. Do you like his horn, Gendre?
Quite so.
There we go, everybody. Gendre is back. You heard him speaking there. It's the first word he said in 2 weeks. Well done, Gendre. Whatever we gave you seems to have worked. Marvellous. Now, Brent, of course, is looking for Kurula, the great queen of Juma. This is not Kurula, don't worry. that's a very macabre joke, wasn't it? This is a leopard, though, and it's a female leopard. And were you to be attacked by a female leopard, that is what would befall you. So quite impressive teeth. You can see they're about probably 2 inches long at the top, slightly shorter at the bottom, about 1 inch. And you can see that this leopard, apart from being in desperate need of dental attention, was quite old. And we can see that from the bluntness there. You can see they're quite blunt. But not as old, I wouldn't say, as Kurula. Well, probably about Kurula's age. If you next time you see her yawn, check out her teeth. They're probably about this blunt, but you can see they're cracked all the way down there. That could have had something to do with the boiling process that took place. Our nail is disgusting. I apologize for that. I'll have it cleaned by the next time you come to the tent. Now, you can ask us any questions you like during the course of the drive. Of course, hashtag SafariLive, questions at wildearth.tv. It'd be lovely to hear from you, and you can ask us any questions about the artifacts you have here. I will try and answer any questions you have about Gendre's disease and whether or not he is, in fact, going to survive through the course of the next 3 hours. Good. Then, the other thing that we have here is a canid. And this is very special. I'm not sure where they got it. I suspect from a breeding project, but this is a wild dog. This is an African wild dog. And during the course of today and over the next week, because of course we'll be in here for the next week, we are going to have an extensive look at this magnificent skull and all the other lovely ones that we have here. And I'll show you the difference in the canid and felid dentition, and we'll try not to damage ourselves with them. Marvelous, right. Gendre is now on his last legs. I'm going to try and revive him. While we do that, let's head across to Steph and find out what he has to show you this afternoon.
Good afternoon and welcome to this PM bushwalk with myself, Steph Winterboer, and Dave is on camera today. And we have been running to get to the side of Juba. I must be honest with you. If it was a hot day, I'd be shining. If the sun had been out today. The reason being is that we wanted to get to a piece of Juma that we have. We don't really come to that often because we have this big signal dip, and bringing you the sort of live magic that we do here from time to time requires us to run from patch of signal to patch of signal. But anyway, we've done it and we've got a pretty special afternoon hopefully lined up for you. We don't quite know what we're going to be finding in here, mainly because we hardly ever come in here. So although we know this patch of bush quite well, we don't really know what's been in here, what's going on here, what came in here last night, what didn't. I can already see from the tracks that were on the ground that there's a possibility of some hippopotamus here. Don't know, for those of you who are watching this morning, Brent heard the Inkahuma lion pride catch a hippopotamus, or at least try and catch a hippopotamus last night. And for the last 10 minutes or so, we've been following a sequence of tracks leading us into this area. The lions moved off, they didn't catch the hippo. The hippo's moved into this area, and there's a little pan just in front of us here, and I want to go and see if that hippo potentially is hiding up in that pan. So come along, let's go and have a look. It's literally just around the corner here. Now, you've got to be a bit careful with hippopotamus. They are... We've got vervet monkeys calling just off to our right-hand side here. Left-hand side, sorry, excuse me. I'm so excited, I don't know what hand... Okay, so vervet monkeys calling. We need to get there. Come with us. We're going to temporarily abandon our hippo search, and in lieu of getting into an area as quickly as we can for where these monkeys are calling from. They could be calling, it sounds like they're calling at a predator, could be lion, could be leopard, could be cheetah, could be wild dog. Any of those, these monkeys would call at. A little bit too far away for me to get that type of call on this microphone. But let me just say, they're probably about 200 or 300 yards from where we are now. Now, you might be thinking, are you crazy running off towards monkeys and lions? Now, well, yes, in a way, but what we're going to do is slow down when we get there. But before we do, and while we're going to hightail it into that area, I think what we're going to do is go and have a look at what one of the others are doing. And we'll catch up with you in a little bit when we get there.
Look at that absolutely gorgeous, gorgeous face. Isn't she absolutely exquisite? We still haven't got a sign of her brother yet, but I think he's in the vicinity. And she's just lying on top of the termite mound, waiting for mom to hopefully come back with dinner. Now, we've started a new game recently, so I'm going to tell you 3 facts about leopards, and 2 of them are going to be the truth, and 1 of them is going to be a lie. Now, the first fact is, I got a good one, is that in Africa and other parts of the world, occasionally big cats turn to man-eating, but the animal that has apparently eaten the most people, a single man-eater, was a leopard. Now, the second fact is that leopards can't swim. And the third fact, now I've got to think. What is the third fact? The third fact is that leopards can run at 24 meters per second. Okay, there are your three facts. Leopards can run at 24 meters per second. Leopards can't swim. And a leopard was the largest, or in terms of man-eating, was recorded eating the largest number of people. There we go, those are your 3 facts. 2 of them are true, 1 is a lie. Okay, I'm just going to move forward a little bit, and we've got Rexon joining us, so he can also have a visual. Okay, so to get your answers in on the two truths and a lie, you can vote on Twitter, and there will be a poll up to see who thinks what is what. But the one thing that's definitely the truth is that this is an absolutely gorgeous little animal. There we go, little Shongile. Now, for those of you who might be new and wondering, what is Shongile? That's a funny sounding word. It is a Shangaan word or a Tsonga word, which is the local language here, and it means exquisitely beautiful. And that she is. Now, I wonder if her brother is down towards the beginning of a little river system. She keeps checking down there. So somewhere around here, possibly the little male cub is. And his name is Hosanna, the little prince. Now there's quite a few people who are wanting to come see these leopards, so we will have to make space for other vehicles just now. But I think while we do that, we're going to go look for Mom. And I think Steph might be on the track of Queen Karula, if he can hear monkey's alarm calling. Incredible patience shown by these cubs. Now, as they get older, the female leopards will leave them in sort of more exposed areas like here. But when they're young, they're left in very, very thick areas, normally around little river systems. But now they're old enough to avoid certain threats. And we've seen these cubs be chased by wild dogs by baboons, and they've managed to survive so far. So valuable lessons taught there. And remember, if you want to ask us any questions about these incredible cats, hashtag Safari Live on Twitter or questions@wildearth.tv. Remember, when you're voting for the two truths and a lie, don't forget to put the hashtag Safari Live. Now, someone was asking about, look how big her paws are. And, well, she's still got to grow into them. Lionheart was wondering how, noticing how massive her paws are. Well, she will grow into them eventually. And she's just over 9 months now. Now, as she gets closer and closer to that year mark, her chances of expiring are a lot less. So basically, leopard cubs have about a 70% mortality rate till they reach a year, and once they've reached a year, that drops rapidly down to about a 10 or 15% mortality rate again till they reach sort of 13 or 14 years and they get older, and that mortality rate rises again. So she's nearly there. She's learnt the lessons about avoiding hyenas, wild dogs, lions, elephants, and all the other fantastic creatures that occur out here in the African bush. So, here are the polls are in. 44% say that fact number one was a lie. And then it was 50% say fact two was a lie. And 6% say fact three was a lie. Well, in fact, it was fact two. So 50% of you are correct. Leopards can swim. They just don't like to do it. And that man-eater of Rappanthwang, I can't really pronounce it, in India, was credited with hunting and killing over 800 people. So that is the largest ever recorded man-eating spate for one cat. I think it probably got a few more added than it really did. You probably find there was actually quite a few more cats that were snacking on people at that time. Okay, so there's someone else who's trying to get into the sighting. I don't think she's going to move. We'll definitely come back here a bit later. And while we do that, James is going to show you the inner workings of some creatures.
Yes, we are, everybody. This is what it looks like when you've been eaten by a leopard, I suppose. Anyway, that's ridiculous. What did I wanted to show you about this leopard skull? I've been doing my researches, you see, and what I wanted to show you is the different kinds of teeth that we have here. And what we have is a molar. You have got two of those. Three. I had two removed, I remember now. There's one molar. Those are the premolars. That's the canine. And these are the incisors. So that is the dental formula. And the dental formula you would read as, well, you'd read it top over bottom. On the top, you'd say 3I, 1C, 2P, 1M. And then on the bottom, if we look over here, you can see the same thing, one molar, but two premolars, or same as the top, really. And all the cats have a slightly different dentition, but that's basically how the leopard's dentition works. So if you happen to be a budding dentist, well, then now you will be fascinated beyond measure. If you are not a budding dentist, you might be asleep. But wake up, because I have something else to show you. There is a monkey skull. Now, this monkey was older than Methuselah. It also had tremendously buck teeth. You can see that. It was in deep need of the same orthodontist who looked after me when I was a child, thankfully. Otherwise, of course, I'd be scraping the lens with my front teeth. But luckily, that is not the case. And the reason I'm showing this to you, of course, is because Steph is following up on this thing, alarm calling. Now, it's probably or most likely alarm calling at a leopard. That is what monkeys like to do. It does have the most startling sort of humanoid feature I always find when I look at that monkey. And often I think it's difficult when you're looking on the screen to see the difference in the sizes of these animals. But this is the leopard skull next to the monkey skull. And you can see how enormous the leopard is in comparison. This is an old monkey. I suspect an old female. I know it's old simply from the way it's been weathered and from the calcifications on the skull, which indicate that it was probably a very old animal when it died, possibly even of old age. Where it died, we don't know. But you can imagine, I mean, that's one bite. And it would hurt quite a lot, don't you think? Yes. Now, Hayley, you're 7 years old. It's lovely to hear from you, Hayley. We especially love to hear from our young wilderness enthusiasts. And you want to know how many skulls we have here? Well, let's have a quick look. I'll ask Gendre to take a step back. Don't fall over, Gendre. I know that you're very tired and ill. Right, here we go. Well, we've got three there, Hayley, and we'll just count them over here. I'll just quickly tell you exactly what they are, and we'll have a look at them in some detail over the next week. That there, if I'm not mistaken, is a jackal. There is a civet. There is a genet. There is a honey badger, believe it or not. That's a serval over there. This is a dastardly baboon. Very big indeed. Then we have, obviously, an impala, very old one. We have a red duiker, which you don't get here. That's a grey duiker, which we do get here, of course. That's a springbok, which we don't get here. Steenbok. And then up at the top here, obviously, we have a beefalo, a great big beefalo, who's had his nose bitten off by the Nkuhuma pride. And then we have a wildebeest. His name is Walter. He looks a bit miserable, I must confess. And there is Zebulon, the zebra, who could have been a racehorse. We're not really sure. Okay, good. And we've got a couple of other warthogs and things down on the bottom shelves, but while we try and count all of them, Hayley, I hope you counted them, and then I want you to tell us, please, how many I showed you. That'll be a good thing for you to do. #SafariLive. Let's head across to Steph and find out if he's found what those monkeys were going at.
Well, today seems like the day for fast marching everywhere. We got to the place where the monkeys were calling. They were calling from inside this marula tree right here. They've now run away as we approached the tree, and no sign of anything. They stopped calling, and I'm not even joking to you, literally when we were just at that line of trees over there, they were still calling. I think that I'm going to be with Brent on this one. I think that Karula, a female leopard that lives in this particular area, is snooping around here somewhere. There was some kudu that were watching us, watching the monkeys, and of course if there was a leopard anywhere between the monkeys and the kudu would also be alarm calling. So I think that there is a very good chance, high probability, that there is a leopard here. I think that the leopard was a bit nervous of the monkeys calling and with the proximity of the kudu and with us coming up from the bottom, sounding like a, must have been like a herd of elephant coming through here. And I think she's moved off. If I were to pick a direction, I would pick the direction that her cubs are in. Now, her cubs are in that direction, probably about 2 or 3 miles from here. As the crow flies, with a deep drainage line or system of very, very thick bush between us and there, a lot of nyala, a lot of kudu, a lot of dacre, a lot of impala in this particular area. So I think what we're going to do now is just take a slow meander through here and see if something else doesn't give away her presence. That monkey troop has moved off following the kudu and away from us, but there's every chance that she bumps into something here that gives another alarm call, and just with us being in this area is enough for us to be a little bit closer than we were where we heard them. How far away? Probably about 300 yards, 350 yards from where we are right now. We heard those monkeys calling and they stopped calling as we got here, which is very typical of vervet monkeys. So don't worry too much about that. We didn't do anything out of the ordinary by running over here. In actual fact, running is always preferable to walking in these instances if you're not too scared about headbutting a buffalo or getting stepped on by an elephant. But I must say, if you do find a leopard, it's well worth it. See, there's a bit of a crime scene over here. It's been astounding the last couple of weeks, probably close on the last couple of months. I know we've had something like 64, 65 odd days, consecutive days of lions and leopard on the reserve. And the sheer number of buffalo that they've been killing is just staggering. This obviously wasn't killed this year. This is a buffalo carcass. Probably a year ago, I would say last dry season, maybe even the dry season before. You can see that the sun has a chance to bleach the bones and the rain and sand to scour them clean. And that's what gives them this white. We've even got two, the hooves that are still left here. Have a look at that. The hoof covering has come off of the foot of this buffalo and is being fed upon over there by the keratin beetle larvae, one of the very, very few organisms out here that can actually digest keratin. This is just keratin, another type of hair. And here we have the skull of the buffalo, washed absolutely clean. Isn't that just gorgeous? I'm actually going to amend my statements. I think that this was probably from a year plus ago. I don't think it's as old as 3 or 4 years, but definitely a year or two. These are the cocoons of the horn moth caterpillar. So them, the horn moth caterpillar and the keratin beetle, are the two organisms that I know of, at least, that can digest keratin. And these funny little protrusions here are the cocoons. Isn't that interesting? Nothing else eats it. You can see not even hyena would be feeding on this. It's almost intact, it's still got its teeth and everything. It's awesome. Have a look there. A grass eater is a buffalo, and definitely one of the big five. Now, a buffalo eat with their heads down, and because they've got this massive horn and skull, they have attachments for muscles like nothing I've ever seen before. Now, I know you were just looking at that collection of bones in the tent with James. And he could perhaps show you in a little bit how different, how massive the attachment point for the neck muscles are here. This is the attachment point for the neck muscles. The buffalo, of course, would be feeding with its head down, feeding grass, eating grass, looking up, eating grass again, and looking up. And that whole thing takes an incredible amount of strength, needing that, or firstly, this hinge, and secondly, the muscles to work that hinge. Have a look at that. I can't remember whether it's the axial or the axis bone. It's the first vertebra that fuses onto the first vertebra of the spine. Just absolutely amazing. All right. On that note, while we meander through here, we're going to be going to go and see what Jamie is getting up to.
Jamie has turned around and completely changed her route, but for a very, very good reason. And the reason is lying up in front of me in the form of the Nkuhumas. I've just got, just bear with me one moment. I just want to think about how we're going to do this. I think we need to go around. But one lioness there, and it looks like the rest of the cubs are hiding off in the bushes over there. There we go. There's one looking, one lioness looking very sleepy. I've also heard a report of the missing two females, so Amber Eyes and the young female, and where they are exactly. I'm just going to, we're just going to do some shuffling around, waving hello to Lex. Let me get out of his way. Which way is he going? Is he going left? Is he going right? Backwards? Which way are we going to go? He is making space for us. What a gentleman. Thanks so much, Lex. Hi, everybody. There we go. Can you still see? Sure. Okay, perfect. Thank you. So there we go. A view of the lions. Thanks very much to Lex for letting us know where they are. I'm going to be speaking quite softly, just because I don't want to disturb the other vehicle, and the lions themselves, of course. And Winter Prison, you of course wondering, I heard from Taylor this morning, you're wondering if there's any word on the missing cub. Apparently this morning, for those of you who missed the sunrise safari, there were only 7 cubs, and all 3 mothers were present and accounted for. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. I can only see 6 at the moment. That doesn't mean that the 7th isn't somewhere around here. I cannot tell. It's quite dense vegetation that they're in. Oh, what's happening there? Big yawn. So unfortunately, no, I can't tell you if the 8th cub has materialized, if it has rejoined the rest of the pride. It's such a difficult thing. We, of course, have become so attached to all 8 cubs. And certainly, that cub could be absolutely alive and well. Remember when the 2 of them went missing and they rejoined the rest of the pride about 3 days later? That could well still happen with this missing cub. Might just have got slightly delayed, perhaps distracted by something exciting. So, we're not going to worry too much yet, but unfortunately it would be extraordinary for the Nkuhumas to have managed to have raised all 8 cubs successfully, with a mortality rate of way over 50% before the lion cubs reach adulthood on average, and that's just on average. It would have been a very, very impressive feat indeed. But I'm still hopeful. Still hoping that the 8th cub might materialize out of the bush. Perhaps just got a little bit too brave and went missing for a little while. In which case, I really hope they manage to find it again. But it's impossible for us to know for sure, and we may never know the answer to that mystery. Right now, I can only count 6. 6 very peaceful-looking lion cubs. Fast asleep. While our lions snooze the afternoon away, let's go and see if James has got something exciting up his sleeve.
Stand still, Jandre. Do not move a muscle. I have it, everybody. The Fossicker-in-Chief Taylor McCarty found us a flea beetle, which I have now recaptured on account of my extremely athletic build. I am not built, however, like this flea beetle, which has legs much more impressive than mine. And almost as impressive as Gendre's, of course, which are... Oh, it's jumped away. No! Oh, no, that's really irritating. They're so hard to catch. Anyway, come over here, and I'll show you what its larva looks like Now, check at that. That is, that is amazing. It is the larva of the flea beetle found by our foster care in chief, Terry McCurdy, and, whew, it looks, you know what? I think it's pupating. I think the larva's inside this, and I think this is the chrysalis. That's exactly what's going on. It's turning into one of those beetles. Slowly, it's turning itself into mush, and in fact, you can see the colours of the adult, which I was going to show you, but unfortunately, because I got above myself, it hopped away and I can't show you. Those colours of black and yellow stripes are sort of what the adult looks like. Now, when he's called a flea beetle because he's so very good at jumping. And the reason I showed you my leg was to compare his femur with mine. He's got a tremendously thick femur, and he uses that to jump with astonishing speed and skill. Is that not wonderful? If not slightly creepy. Right, we're going to have a look at the plant that it's on. Now, the plant is called Rus Gwenzii. There it is. Now, Rus Gwenzii is apparently, well, it's not toxic to human beings, but that larva that is sitting there on the Rus Gwenzii is apparently very toxic, and it used to be used by the bushmen to poison their arrows. Let's squeeze out the insides of that larva onto the arrow, and then they would, well, hopefully catch something for dinner. Maybe a scrub hare or something like that. Marvellous. Very nice there. Now, the other thing I have to show you under the microscope, we, of course, are now in the throes of summer. It hasn't felt like it today. It's a rather miserably cold day. But there's been a lot of rain, which means there have been a lot of insects around. And one of the things that you don't want sitting on you is this thing. Ye olde Spanish fly. That there, everybody, is a blister beetle. And the blister beetle, of course, is born of cantharidin in the abdomen. And what that means is that if it walks on you, you will blister and itch. And in fact, you know, it used to be used, if you can believe it, as the Spanish fly, which of course was where, when I was at school, if people mentioned Spanish fly, you giggled because it was supposed to be some kind of aphrodisiac. What it does is create an irritation of the urinary tract, and that's why people used to think it was an aphrodisiac. Let's have a quick look at it underneath the microscope. I'm just going to put it, sorry, Kirsten, don't shout at that just now. There we are. Look at its eye. Very impressive eye, and likewise, it's equally impressive bright yellow antenna, which give it its distinctive sort of look. Isn't that amazing? Very cool. I think that's so marvellous. Oh, beautiful. Now, we were told, or Steph was telling you earlier on, that yesterday evening there was an attack on a hippopotamus. Now, we have sight of, I think, probably the very hippopotamus that Steph was talking about, and it's in the dam now. There it is. Thank you, Zumi. Very kind framing there. That is the hippopotamus. You can see it's just opened its eyes. It realizes now, of course, that it's on live television. And it is very unusual for lions to take on hippo, as Steph said, but it's not impossible. And I think now that we're moving out of the drought and there's more and more standing water around the place, I think it's going to be more and more difficult for the lions to take out things like hippo, because the hippo are going to put on condition quite quickly. But certainly they will, in some parts of the world, of Africa, take hippo quite often. And even here, if there is a really severe time, the hippo will get weakened enough for lions to be able to take them. Now, that is not rain falling on the surface. I think it's probably the breathing of fishes. And maybe not fish, maybe terrapins, because I don't think there are any fish in there yet. It might even be the odd spot of rain. But, of course, we are completely safe and dry here in the tent, which cannot be said for Jamie. She's with the lions and no rain just yet.
No rain just yet, although I have to say that the southern the southern, what's it called? Horizon, that's what it's called. Definitely looked like it was going to rain a little bit, but that's good. That is good news for our amazing lion cubs. There you go, you can see the clouds. There's still a little bit of light poking through and shining down upon us, but it does seem to be getting darker and darker by the second. But for our lions, particularly these Nkuhuma cubs with mange, that rain, any rain, is going to be an amazing thing. It will help to wash it away. Oh, Brian, on the top of the tree there, on the dead tree, could it be? Oh, it's a brown-headed kingfisher. I got excited for a moment, but actually now, in hindsight, woodlands kingfishers are much, much larger than that. I thought we'd seen our first woodlands. I got very, very excited. Equally as cool, that is not to say that this poor brown-headed kingfisher is not in any way as amazing, but it is not quite what I was aiming for. I was going for the first woodlands kingfisher of the season. Sorry, kingfisher, I didn't mean to insult you. You're still lovely and still very beautiful. Oh! Choop, 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 choop. What a lovely call. Choop, choop, choop. Well, the reason that one of the reasons that we focus on watching a bird like that making that call is that for those of you who are really trying to learn all of the different bird calls of this area, seeing the actual bird making the call, I promise you, is the best way of cementing the calls in your mind. So for when you're watching the dam camera and you can't see the bird calling, that's the best way to go about it. Right, so that was a brown-hooded kingfisher. I was talking about the rain and our... Oh, I'm sorry. Just listening to the Game Drive channel, which is crucial to the way we do things. But yes, with the mange, which I think the Nkuhuma cubs are really, truly throwing off, they're going to recover, they're going to get better. But the rain will most definitely help the things along, help to wash it away, and obviously bring relief to them as well. So earlier on, we were talking about the missing cub, and I said I could only count six. I was mistaken, I can count seven. You can see when you've got a pile of cubs just like this, all tangled together, it gets a little bit more tricky in terms of distinguishing one from the other. But if we look really closely, there we go. That is the seventh Nkuhuma cub in a bundle of patch just behind the fallen log. So there's seven of them here. Oh, our lioness is up. Big stretch. Already looking hungry and empty-bellied, even though they've just finished off a massive buffalo bull in the last three or so days. And I think the presence of the two males would most definitely have reduced the amount of food that they were able to eat. And we can guarantee that this evening they will be hunting, but they might even hunt this afternoon. Just searching for a slightly more comfortable spot and a slightly less visible one. Now, Renee, you wanted to know why is it that the lions do not run away from our vehicle? And the answer to that, Renee, is that they have no reason to fear us. And these lions, just like these cubs, I mean, we've been watching these cubs since they were very, very small. All of the big cats of the Sabi Sand have grown up from being tiny cubs with the presence of vehicles in their lives, and they have learnt that we do not mean... Aw, cute. Bit of a head rub there. They have learned that we don't mean them any kind of threat or any danger. We're not going to hurt them, we're not going to get too close to them, we're not going to scare them. They've come to trust us, essentially, and we've become, well, maybe, yes, trust, I suppose, is a good way of describing it. But we're a part of their environment. We're not quite like a tree or a termite mound, which is the analogy I sometimes use, because, of course, we move, and the vehicle does make a little bit of noise, and it does smell a little bit different. So it would be impossible to say that they're not aware of us, but they're not in any way bothered by us. As you can tell, I mean, just look at them. They couldn't look more comfortable and peaceful, although I'm not so sure that one cub is that comfortable, kicking its cousin in the head to try and shift it off. I think that that little cub has found the perfect pillow. Doesn't that look comfortable, Brian? Mm. Sort of.
Yeah.
Sort of. It looks a bit slippery, like it can't quite rest its head comfortably. I'm going to sit patiently here and wait for the little lion cubs to start gambling about, as they are wont to do on these cool, cloudy days. Let's go across to Brent. I heard he was looking for leopards, or helping Steph and Herbie look for leopards. Let's go see if he's succeeded.
Well, isn't that wonderful? Having a lion and leopard already on the sunset safari. Now, Steph heard those monkeys alarm calling, so we've come into the area to give a hand, see if we can't help find what we think is probably Karula, who's mother to that beautiful cub we saw a little earlier. And Steph's checking behind us, so I just want to check through here, and then I'm going to drop down to the Mwati River. We're going to see if she's heading back towards those cubs. Maybe she's made a kill, we don't know. Now, if she has made a kill, She's gonna go back to the cubs, she's gonna fetch them, and she's gonna lead them back to where the meat is. So, good thing we've got people watching the cubs in case she absolutely diverts around us. We spoke a little bit about how leopard cubs hunt, and Andy in Kentucky is wondering what age do they start going on hunts with mom. Well, they don't ever really. Now, a cub is a very bad thing to have on a hunt. They tend to scare everything, jump in the way, so they master their hunting techniques when mom's away, like there. So if a little stenbok happened to wander across up to, or a lizard, anything, they'll chase and catch them, and that's where they master their hunting skills. Now, they're just over 9 months old now, and in certain circumstances it's been recorded that leopards have become independent and survived from as young as 9 months. But normally a female, probably 12 to 14, 15 months, so in less than 6 months it's likely that Shongile will almost be out on her own most of the time, whether as young Hosana will spend probably up to about 2 years with his mother. And it's very difficult, and you can even start noticing it now. Just before we went on leave, or when I went on leave, I saw that those wild dogs that rushed into where Karula had the kill, and Shongile was already street smart, long way out of the way before the dogs got very close. Otherwise young Hosana was not quite there, and I've noticed when we had her on another kill that even when Karula was coming back from having a drink, Shongile wasn't sure whether it was her mother or not, so she slunk off and hid to make sure it was safe. So she's already displaying some independence from her brother and from her mother at this young age. Now, of course, there's no set hard and fast rules out here in the African bush. Each day is different, and each individual creature is different on that depending day. So it's very, 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 what's the word I'm looking for? It's very presumptuous to make blatant statements, because in the next 20 minutes you could be proved wrong. Now, of course, it's not only the big hairies and scaries that are wonderful, there's also some incredibly exquisite little creatures. So let's go have a look at one of those with Steph.
This is definitely scary. This is one of the largest predatory ants that we find. In actual fact, it is the largest predatory ant that we find out here. This morning, Justin S. asked me on safari, what is the largest ant that we find here? And this is one of them. This is that ant. I don't want to put my finger too close, but I just want to give you an idea of size. Let's see if we can get him onto a stick for you, or at least coax him to come back. Now, they live singly. I've never seen these species of ant actually hunt cooperatively. And then from a very nondescript nest, it's just really a hole in the ground. But you do find them in deep summer all over the place. And just have a look at how majestic this particular ant is. And I'm sure they'll give you a nasty nip. if you got a little bit too cheeky. But there you go, crawling off into the undergrowth. Now that isn't why we actually stopped over here, to be quite honest. He just came out of the undergrowth while we were waiting to show you him. What we came here for is the fact that we spied a tortoise that is quite obviously dead. Have a look over there. We haven't yet investigated this tortoise just yet. It's a tortoise that is lying on its back, but pieces of its shell has come off. And so let's go and have a look and see if we can see what has caused this tortoise's end. This is a leopard tortoise. I can tell that just from its size and also from the coloration on its shell. Now, I'm not going to touch these tortoises. Not that I'm scared of it jumping up and biting me again or something living in it. It's just that I don't quite know what killed it. What it looks like to me is it's been turned over on its back. But with these pieces of the shell broken off, I'm almost wanting to say when we turn it over here, we might even find that there are some tooth marks on the top. No, I almost can tell you exactly what has killed this. This has been killed by a southern ground hornbill. So southern ground hornbill are very large birds with very robust beaks. And what's happened is that southern ground hornbill has used their beak as a hammer and hammered through the top of the shell and picked out the tortoise's insides on the inside and then just discarded it. You probably find that in flicking the last little bits of meat off of the shell on the inside, that the tortoise was then left on its back. Why do I think it's the southern ground hornbill? Because if it were a lion or a hyena that had preyed upon this particular tortoise, there would be teeth marks in the bottom of this tortoise's shell, and then no teeth marks there. And then when we turned it over, the tortoise having been cleaned out like that, but without the legs being eaten, you can see the legs are still intact there, and the tail, and there. So it wasn't something small that had killed this. This was something large that had killed this, but without the canines. Isn't that fascinating? So leopard tortoise, I think, killed by a southern ground hornbill, or by a family of southern ground hornbills. They're big birds. They're big. They're like turkey size, and have got a long beak on them, about this long, and they use that beak to hammer down onto the shell with enough force to break the shell open. They would have then pecked this poor tortoise to death, eaten it, and discarded the leftover shell for us to find here. Isn't that amazing? Can't find its head. Literally just, the head would have come out over here. So literally just the pelvis and the hip that we're seeing here now. Gives us a nice look at the inside of a tortoise shell. This is the pelvis fused to an extension of the hip there and there. And then this would have been the shoulder blades and the ribs, which have fused together to form the bottom piece of the tortoise. So what we're seeing here, the shell, this is the ribs, pelvis, shoulder blades, or breastbone at least, excuse me. So it's the breastbone, ribs, sternum, pelvis of the tortoise. Would have come up into the hips. And then right here, you can actually see a piece of the vertebra there. And then over the top of the shell, the vertebra would have come out over the top. And once again, the shell is made up of the hips, the elongated and flattened out spine, the ribs, and the shoulder blades, and the clavicles, I can't even remember what they're called. These little bones over here, collarbones. These little bones, I'm going, touch it, remember my biology lessons? So it would have been the clavicles. And that is exactly what you're seeing. And all the organs then on the inside and attached on the inside with the thin color covering, the scales, the tortoise shell, then covering that on the other side. Isn't that amazing? Shame, poor guy. Relatively fresh, you can still see there's some movement there. Although that's mainly just skin. And you know what, the other day, it was probably last week sometime, Jamie had a roving group of southern ground hornbills that were feeding across Juma, and it was probably them that killed it. There's a tortoise foot. I'm not quite sure if this is considered lucky. Nevertheless, tortoise foot. Bring it back to James in his tent. And talking about James in his tent, we're going to send you across there. He's also got a tortoise shell to show you.
Well, I've got what was a tortoise, of course, and I want to show you a little bit about what could have eaten that thing 2 million years ago. 2 million years ago, of course, something like this, or let's make it, I don't know, let's call it 200,000 years ago, rather, this kind of implement, the red-billed buffalo weaver gave me a fright. This kind of implement could have been designed not by a modern human being, it could have been designed by a modern human being, but also by one of our ancient ancestors that used to lope about in this area. And what they would have done is to take the hard edge of this and smash the top of the tortoise shell. Now, I just want to give you an idea of the sound, so I'll put it right next to my head. Now, I'm hitting this thing quite hard, and it's not breaking. I don't think. No, it's not breaking. So you can imagine the amount of force required to break open that tortoise shell. And the only other thing with a tool like this attached to the front of its face, of course, is the ground hornbill, which I think Steph told you. Right. Now, up over here, we have something very interesting. And it's a glorious plant called white jasmine. Now, if you were watching yesterday, Taylor McCurdy, you would have seen her show you one of these on drive. But this is the creeper in close relief. And what I want to show you, apart from the beautiful flower, which I'm going to smell for you now and then try and describe it, watch how the, what did we call this? It's not the trunk, it's the stem, has dug into this very thick and slow-growing cambritum wood. It's dug right into it, all the way down. So this association has been going on unfettered and unhindered for some time for the creeper to have got in there. So it's growing in a cambritum apiculatum or red bush willow tree. Here's one of the flowers that has actually come to fruition, as it were. Gorgeous. You see that, Chandra? See how gorgeous it is. Chandra is not speaking anymore again, everybody. I think he might be close to a collapse. All right, now I'm going to smell it. Now, I've said to many of you, of course, that one of the great joys of living out here is that, thank you, Chandra. Apparently that was an uncomfortable close-up, everybody. We do apologize for Chandra. One of the great joys of living out here, of course, is the fact that you get these amazing smelling things. And I love smelling different things out here, and it depends on the different seasons. In winter, I love the smell of wood smoke and dust, but in summertime, especially as we head towards Christmas, I love the smell of new flowers. And this smells like a really sweet jasmine, but it's slightly more subtle. It's not quite as strong. Gorgeous. Marvellous. Okay, good. I'm just going to quickly pick these things up as I deal with the comment from Judy H. Judy H, you say, my earpiece matches my shoelaces. It does. Look, the shoelaces are quite cool. The earpiece is inescapably horrific, but unfortunately it's the only thing that I can make work at the moment, and we will desperately try and fix that situation shortly. Let's head back to Jamie and the lion cubs and hope desperately that the new, or the one, the missing one, has been sighted.
Unfortunately, it doesn't look as though the one is back at the moment. I've still only managed to count 7. This little one has gone from one female to the other while we've been sitting here looking for a place to suckle, and has finally settled upon the female that is closest to us. I was quite surprised when I came back to still see that some of the females were lactating. I'm not sure, and correct me if I'm wrong, I'm not sure if all of the females are lactating, or all 3 mothers are lactating, or if it's only a couple of them remaining, 1 or 2, that are still producing milk, or if it is all 3. If it is all 3, I'm very, very impressed with them. I suppose, though, they've had plenty of access to food and nutrients. She looks so peaceful. Paws crossed, not a care in the world. You can just see, hidden in the tufts of black fur, those claw sheaths that hide those razor-sharp claws of hers. Our lionesses don't seem to be terribly concerned with the fact that they have missed or have lost one of their number. They weren't terribly concerned the last time either that two of them went missing. And Monique, in London, as always, welcome to the Sunset Safari. Do you want to know if we know whether the missing cub is part of the older, middle, or teddy bear cub litter? And Monique, I'm honestly not sure. I've actually been trying to work it out myself. But it's quite, especially when they're flat like this, it's actually relatively difficult to tell the difference between the different litters. So for those of you that have joined us for the first time, perhaps this is your first time seeing the Nkuhuma cubs, you might not know just how many there are. There are 8 of them, but they belong to 3 different mothers, so 3 different litters. Oldest being about 6 months nearly old. No, that can't be right. 5.5 months? It's nearly 6 months old. The middle one's just a little bit younger than them. And then the teddy bear, or the youngest set of cubs, are about a month younger than that. So it's quite easy to tell the littlest ones, and I'm pretty sure I've counted all 3 little ones. I'm just trying to work out if that's... It's just this puddle of cubs in front of me that's a bit difficult to tell. I think that the cub facing us, lying on its left-hand side, I think that's one of the littlest cubs. And then I definitely know that one there on the right, I think, is one of the littler ones. And then I definitely know that the one hidden behind the log that we now can't see at all is a little cub, is a teddy bear cub litter. That was James's phrase, by the way. He coined that term, and I think it was entirely fair. This one here, you can just see the tip of an ear, if you look really closely, tip of an ear, that is also a little one. And then I suspect that the one that is... Which one is the one that's suckling? This isn't one of the littler ones. I think this is one of the middle ones. Monique, after that long-winded explanation, to be completely honest, I'm not sure. I don't know which one is missing. I think it might be one of the oldest ones, but I really, really am not 100% confident in that. And of course, because I haven't had a good chance to have a look at their bottoms or underneath their tails, I don't even know if the missing one is a male or female. We know that we've got 3 males and 5 females, thanks to the dedicated work of our viewers in order to sex them when we first started seeing them all together. But I don't know which one's missing. We'll have to wait and see. The lucky thing is, of course, that it's quite cool this afternoon. So there's a chance that at some point, a little bit later, they might decide to get up and start playing, being slightly more energetic, as lion cubs often are. As James has told us before, lion cubs always seem to be very busy. When they're awake, they're always up to something, whether it's chewing and attacking a piece of grass or leaf or twig or a sibling or a cousin, jumping and tree climbing, practicing all the things they're going to need to be able to do. Look how big their feet are. I know we often remark upon this, but they just seem to have such enormously big feet. Like big dog puppies, Great Danes and the like, with their enormous, vast, almost clown-sized feet in comparison to the rest of them. Such big paws. They've just got to grow into them now. All in all, this is a thoroughly contented scene. Absolutely beautiful. We're so lucky that we can sit and enjoy these moments in their lives. Twitching. Don't see a fly there. That might even be a dream twitch. Well, since our lion cubs don't seem to be up to terribly much right this moment, I think it's time we sent you back across to Steph, who for some reason is digging.
Now, one of the things that is of great interest to me out here is the traditional, the medicinal uses of all the plants that we find here. Now, yesterday, while we were on safari, while we were walking around, we found this huge bulb. It must have been about this big, about as big as two soccer balls next to one another, or 2 footballs next to one another. But I couldn't at the time find the plant that it came from. I couldn't show you at least anyway, and it's given us some time now. I've now found it. This is the Dema plant, as the local Isitsonga people call it. The Dema vine comes out in a plant like this, and attached to it is this bulb. And that's what I'm trying to excavate a little bit here for you to see. Don't worry, these plants are incredibly robust. They get fed on by almost everything out here. They're also a highly traded commodity. In the traditional medicines, this plant is used as a fixative almost. It's, in other words, mixed with a lot of other roots and potions, I suppose, for lack of a better word, and it binds them all together, makes them all work. But just have a look at that. Now, this particular one, I'm just finding more and more and more of it as I dig. It's got a funny shape, as you can see there. And it's coming out, look at that. I'm not going to dig out the whole one, I just wanted to show you. Now, in the dry season, we've seen elephant dig up these roots and these tubers to basically get a lot of water. And there's a lot of water inside these tubers. Let me show you right there. Have a look at that side of it. Let me just squeeze it there for you.
No luck yet with Queen Karula. We are going to head back to where we had Shongile at the beginning of drive. Hello, little one. Oh, it's getting to a better spot for the for you there. Little dwarf mongoose. Okay, where did he go? He disappeared. Oh, there he is. Now, we do apologize for jumping from a little bit to the left. A little bit more. There he is. Hello, little one. We do apologize for the quick jump across to us, but we are live in the middle of the African bush, and occasionally the satellites don't align correctly, or something of that. Unfortunately, I don't know much about tech stuff. I stick to the animals, and this is definitely one of my favorite little animals. The dwarf mongoose. They live in little communities that are called businesses. Anything from about 10 to 25, 30 individuals, and are led by an alpha pair. Look at that little nose! Sniffing! They are exclusively diurnal, so they're only out and about during the day. And he's making sure we're not up to trouble or a possible threat, giving us a good look. Well, he's got the safety of a burrow to retreat in. And it's an old termite mound that he's up against there. And they will have about 5 to 20 different permanent home burrows that they'll stay in within their territory, but numerous bolt holes. And I don't think this is a home burrow, I think this is a bolt hole. So if there's a perceived threat, they get close to the bolt hole just in case they need to go all the way down to get away from birds of prey mostly, but even young leopard cubs. Oh, a little bit of light coming through, you can see he's got a sparkle in his eye. Here's another one. And quite often, if you sit quietly with them, more and more appear. There we go, a bit of grooming going on. And with all social animals, particularly social carnivores, aloe grooming, which is what that is an incredibly important part of their daily rituals to keep the bonds of the different members nice and strong. There we go, you can see that's a little boy. Oh. Now, they're great foragers. Now, they have a very, very diverse diet from plant matter, insects, and arachnids, spiders, scorpions, occasionally snakes. So, reptiles, geckos, lizards, and one of their favorite foods, if they can find them, is the eggs of ground nesting birds. They also eat snake eggs and tortoise eggs if they can find them. Here we go. You can see how tiny he is. He probably only weighs about 8 grams. Now, Iodine in Illinois would like to know whether people have dwarf mongooses pets. Now, unfortunately, as lovely as it would seem, having wild animals as pets is not a good idea. Now, while I was growing up, I had a bit of a bigger species of mongoose, the banded mongoose. We had them, a few different ones as pets that were rescued. Now, they don't really fit into the normal pet sphere. So one of their most prominent features that is very important to the mongoose is its anal gland and scent marking from it. So if you want to have a mongoose as a pet, you need to realize you are going to be scent marked by anal glands regularly. Now, many visitors to our household while I was growing up could found that very disturbing, and then jumping up and screaming generally causes the mongoose to bite. And even though they are small, they've got razor sharp little teeth that can inflict a lot of damage. So the best place for the mongoose is out in the bush and not at home. If you really like wild animals, or actually if you really love wild animals, you leave them in the wild. If you generally, quite often what happens is that people like the way animals make them feel without consideration to the animals. So wild is the best place for wild animals. Always a very confused look on the one in front, sort of bemused. I have little pink noses here, sniff, 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 sniffing. Okay, well, we're going to leave the dwarf mongoose to sun themselves in what little late afternoon light there is. We're going to keep moving, keep searching for Karula. And while we do that, it seems like Steph's satellites have aligned. So let's go have a look.
We're back again. Sorry for crash cutting away from you like that, or crashing away from you, as we call it. And back to Brent, you know, getting you this bushwalk from the middle of the bush here sometimes requires some gymnastics on David's part to get the signal past all these bushes. But I'm still with this Derma plant, this tuber that we found out here. And just to show you how much liquid is actually in these shavings, have a look at how much I'm squeezing out there. Incredible, hey? So a lot of moisture, and that the animals have been using over this drought period. But Steenbuck actually farm these particular tubers. So they dig out these tubers, they'll feed on it a little bit, and then they cover it up again. And that way it doesn't kill these tubers. These tubers are incredibly robust. Even the little bit of damage that I did out here will very quickly be fixed again. And I'm just going to add the soil back so that it composts. Now, Penny Pine, you've just asked me if the soil here is acid or alkaline. I don't actually know the answer to that, Penny Pine, to be honest with you. I don't know what the pH level of the soil actually is, to be honest with you. It's definitely not alkaline, because you'd find a lot of potassium here. We don't have that. This is quite a rich humus soil. Have a look at here. You can see how full of compost, how full of humus that soil actually is. Not a lot of clay. If I squeeze it like this, it doesn't really stick together, as you can see there. As we get closer down the slope, we'll start finding more clay, and as we go further up the slope, you start finding more sand. But right here, where we are sort of mid-slope, this is the soil that we have here. Quite a nice soil, quite a nicely fertile soil, and because of it you get such a lot of plant growth here. Alrighty, so I've now taken that plant and covered it up there. You can see, left that vine all to itself. We'll carry on, pat it down, leave it there for the next. Isn't that awesome? Very, very cool thing to do. All right, let's carry on down the slope. David's just hung up on some branches over there. Sorry. I've got this big aerial on the back of this backpack, and it sometimes catches on bushes and branches that are just at the right height. Now you can see in front of us it's starting to get a little bit thicker, and that's because we are decreasing in altitude. We're going downslope towards a thicker patch of bush, and we've got a drainage line there, and I want to go and see. I've never walked into this patch of bush before, to be quite honest. It's the first time that I'm in this particular patch, and although I know the drainage line, where it comes, where it goes, I don't quite know exactly what is over here, and I'm quite excited to show you if there's anything there of note. But anyway, while I get myself through this, we are going to send you over to James.
Special here, everybody. It's a millipede, but we're hoping to try and get it to climb over the lens. And it came in here. We've been inundated by beautiful little beautiful little invertebrates. We've got beetles and we've got spiders and we've got this millipede. And there we go. There we go. Oh, isn't he cool? But the feeling of having these millions of or thousands of legs walking over me is just wonderful. He doesn't like my face. Now, I'm sure to many of you this would be an absolutely terrifying experience, but it's only because I'm experienced in these ways that it isn't terrifying to me. It certainly used to be before I moved to the bush. I was most afraid, not afraid, but I didn't like the feeling of creepy things on me. Isn't he cool? Now, he's filled with cyanide, so I'm being very gentle with him, because they can start to smell utterly disgusting when they don't like you very much, and then they open up a very large bottom at the end there, and out of it comes an evil-smelling black substance, which I suppose you might term feces. You might term it something else, too, if it did it to you. All right, let's release him. I wanted to show you something else while we were here. Go on, you go and play. Yes, come on, that's it. Now, we've got two very special we've got one very special caterpillar. Oh, there's the other one. Look at this one. Look at this rather terrifying-looking creature. And you see, it's not on the plant that it was found. That's why it's looking distressed about what its dinner is. We're going to put it back on its plant. It was found on something called Dicrostachys cinerea, or the Chinese lantern bush. And what we'll try and do is have a look at it under the microscope. I'll just take the microscope out here. Isn't he amazing? And then I'm going to show you another one of similar sort of thing. Look at that. How cool is that? He's now trying to get into the microscope. Now, he's coloured like a tiger, of course, because he's very, very toxic, I suspect. And he's been sitting on Dicrostachys, and he will probably extract some kind of compound from the Dicrostachys plant, which in turn makes him toxic. I think that is just wonderful. Isn't that great? And anything out here, we know this, of course, and Steph will tell you this when he's doing his survival things, anything out here that is black and orange and red and white and yellow, you don't touch, because it will be toxic. It's a warning. It's nature's way of saying, don't touch this, you'll be in trouble. Now, I'm going to show you one more kind of a caterpillar now. It's in here, and it is blue. It's a beautiful blue colour. We'll do it under the microscope first, and then I'll show you. Oh, look at that. That is just gorgeous. Look at the colours on this caterpillar, everybody. Found on a completely different species of plant. Now, every single caterpillar, of course, has a different host plant, and this one's host plant, Taylor found it on something called the red spikethorn. Look at the little portholes it has. Yeah, now I was rather hoping this question wouldn't be asked. Samantha, you want to know what butterflies these things make? I don't know. It's difficult to tell. We think maybe this blue one, because the adult is blue, the blue Charaxes, it's possible. But really, it's difficult to say. It does have a Charaxes kind of look about it. It's now sitting on the microscope. We'll have to show you that. You'll see. There it is there. Ooh. Now, there's a storm coming in. I can feel it blowing now. The unfortunate caterpillar has now soiled itself, so we'll have to go and put it back in its tree. It's very scared indeed. Good. Okay, then we will also take this thing out and see if we can't find a Dicrostachys bush to put it back on. Because we don't want to. What this is a it's a square raisin, or Gruvia flavescens, and at least sandpaper raisins, sorry. And Gruvia flavescens, of course, is not the preferred food of this little thing. Now, we need to find a Dicrostachys bush out here. And I'm not sure where there is one. Here's one right here. So he will be very happily placed on this Dicrostachys bush here. And then he will eat. Get off. Go on. Right, well, while I try and shake off this sort of leonine caterpillar, we'll head back across to Jamie Patterson and see if her search for the eighth cub has gone any better than it did last time. Goodbye.
No cub has come back, unfortunately. We are still with just 7 Nkuhuma cubs. However, we have lost one other member, which is a female who has gone across to have a drink towards the Juma Dam. So for those of you, James included, who are watching the Juma Dam camera, keep an eye out. She could pop out any moment now. I think she might be on her way to have a drink. The rest of them are sort of showing signs of stirring. I'm seeing the odd yawn, the odd tail flick. Somebody definitely doesn't want to get up though. Could you imagine a more relatable expression on a little lion cub's face just before it has to get up and start moving around? Clearly just wants to stay in bed for 5 more minutes. Especially when it's got such a comfortable pillow / hot water bottle to keep it warm and cozy. There's no such thing as your personal space bubble when you're a lion cub, or any kind of a lion. They're quite happy to just lie on top of each other. Just goes to show just how tightly bonded the members of the pride truly are. Thoroughly asleep. And as the cubs snooze away, every now and again I see a head up, the odd yawn, but the females don't seem to be too keen on joining their pride mate when she heads across to have a drink. They are still fast asleep. There's one that's settled a little bit further behind the vehicle. There we go. Now, at first when the female got up, I thought perhaps she might be on her way to go and hunt something. But the lackluster response of the other two females, the other two adult females, suggests to me that maybe she's just gone to go and have a drink. And it's amazing how this wordless communication works between different members of a pride. And Kamira, that brings us into the answer to your question, which is why do lions have black on the back of their ears? And the answer is they have black on the back of their ears and the back of their tails because it's a colour that stands out most clearly given their coloration. You can see how in this sort of light or any sort of light and in this dense vegetation, the black sticks out very, very clearly. And there's a couple of reasons behind that. One is that the most important body parts in terms of a lion's body language, and they can't talk to each other, but they do talk in the form of body language, and most of that is done through the face, the ears, and the tail. And yes, body posture also plays a big role, but the ears play an essential part of that communication. I don't know if you have any dogs or cats at home, Kamira, or perhaps you're a horse person and you happen to have interacted a lot with horses. But you know that an ear or a tail flick can tell you all you need to know about your pet's mood. And if you see an animal with its ears flat back, you know that they're not happy, or the tail thrashing, you know they're not happy. And it works exactly the same way with lions. However, lions, of course, as a social hunter, have taken this one step further, and there's a lot of evidence to suggest that lions actually coordinate their hunts using the twitches of their ears. Now, of course, that'll take a long time to prove, but I wouldn't be at all surprised if that were the case. Makes total sense to me, because if you've ever watched a lion hunt, it is one of the most incredibly coordinated things you can witness in the bush. And I don't know how they do it. Somehow they just know when to stay put, when to move, when to go somewhere. The way that they move about, fan out or stay together. It's absolutely, truly poetry to watch. And all done, of course, without one single word. And that's because they don't need to make a sound. They can communicate through the language of their bodies. Well, that's why they have the black on the back of their ears. The tail also helps cubs to follow them. The emphasis on the black of the back of the tail will also help cubs to follow them when the cubs are still relatively little, especially if they're moving through thick, tall grass. She definitely doesn't have any hunting on her mind, though. And if you want a slightly more humorous sort of interpretation of a lion hunt and the way in which they communicate with each other, you might want to have a look at Billy Connolly's The Wildebeest Hunt. Not now, please. Don't disappear from our show just to go and watch it right now. But if you do find yourself looking for entertainment after our live safaris, after our sunset safari, please feel free to go and Google Billy Connolly's The Wildebeest and the way that he describes the movement of the lionesses. Definitely not for those of you, though, that are sensitive to any kind of profanity, just to put a warning out there for you. Sorry, I'm now giggling to myself thinking about it. I'm trying to snap back my attention back to the present. Our lion cubs are well and truly relaxed on this gorgeous afternoon, and it seems as though Brent has made his way back across to the Princess of Juma. Let's go and have a look at a cub of a different kind.
And as I don't know who's more relaxed, the lion cubs or young Shongile, who's coiled herself into a ball as it starts to get a bit colder and is fast asleep. Isn't that just too precious? Same termite mound we left her on. Still no sign of young Hosanna. He's probably sleeping on another termite mound or a bush somewhere around here. But I think our best chance at finding Mum is to sit tight and see if she comes back for the cubs during this sunset safari. Now, the reason they like to sleep on top of termite mounds is it's a little bit safer, gives it a little bit of high ground in case anything happens to come start stomping towards her, whether it be a big, nasty male lion or an inquisitive baby elephant. It gives her a bit of time to assess her options and skedaddle in the correct direction. Quite often, with things like elephants, she'll just make herself, well, I don't know if she can make herself more flat than that, but she probably can, and it all just depends on each unique situation, what a leopard cub will do when it's encountered by other creatures when Mom is out hunting. Now, the temperature has dropped quite a bit, and the sky is darkening to the south, so there is a chance of us getting a little wet, but I'm hoping that it does rain, but after the sunset safari. Well, hi, Haley. Haley is 7 years old. Wonderful to have you with us, Haley. Very excited that you're joining us. Now, Haley would like to know, how many leopards do we have in our park? Well, Haley, that's a difficult question because it's always changing. But adult resident leopard, that means they're always around and they live here permanently, on Juma and on Arethusa, we have Karula, which is the mom of Shongile, who we're looking at. We have Shadow. And we have Tengana. Those are probably the three we see most regularly. But down on Cheetah Plains, we can see Tandi. And we can see Nkanyeni. So that's five. Now, also, we can see Shivamba Lion, who's another male down there. And Quarantine. So we're on seven. And in between, we sometimes see... what's her name now? Big female from the west... Salaheshe, we might see Ingrid Dan cub, but we might see Tsakani. So there's a lot, but probably around 8 or 9 that we see regularly. at that. Fast, fast asleep. Now, Andrew is on his way to come join us here. Got to talk to him, but I'll talk to him just now. Remember, this is 100% live, so we've got to play the patience game today. And hopefully, while we're sitting here, maybe she starts playing with her brother, who I'm sure was hiding around here somewhere. Or Mom comes back and calls them and takes them back to a fresh kill. Wouldn't that be very exciting? But while we're sitting here, I think it's time to put all your brains into gear with a nearly impossible tree quiz. What do you think, Vim? All right, Vim likes cats more than trees, but this is a funny looking little tree right here. So we'll do the tree on the termite mound where young Shongile is. You can see the colors of the leaves are quite strange. Some of them are reddish, others are green. I'll give you a little clue. We normally see these trees when they're much, much bigger. But if you know what this little tree is, send your answers through to hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. There, VM showing you the bark. There we go. And now there's a very particular reason why the young leaves are red, but I'm going to only tell you once someone figures out what the tree is. So there we go. If you know the answer, hashtag Safari Live or questions at wildearth.tv. What is the nearly impossible tree of today? Now, Scott said he's read that the markings of a leopard are tattooed onto the skin. Is that true? Scott, I've never heard that before, but I would say there's probably maybe some pigment change in the skin where the different dark spots are, but I wouldn't say they're tattooed into the skin. I'm sorry, Andrew's calling me. He's trying to find out exactly where we are, because we're not on a road, we're in the middle of the bush. So I'm just going to help him make his way towards us. Well, someone else is talking on the radio, so we'll wait a second, and while VM gives you a tour of that exquisite coat. Oh, do you hear that, VM? Not sure what I heard. Almost thought I heard maybe Karula coming. Oh, the nearly impossible tree quiz was too quickly answered today. I'm gonna have to find a harder tree. Indeed, Raisa, you are spot on. It is a jackalberry. Sorry, Andrew's calling me again. Andrew, just come to the junction, Shibam and Treehouse, you'll get my visual. Here we go. Well done, Raisa. That is a young jackalberry. Oh, okay, it sounds like I'm going to have to do a little bit more explaining to get Andrew into where we are. So while we do that, let's go see what Commander Bond is up to in the tent.
I am playing caveman, caveman slash Neanderthal, Neanderthal. And of course, I'm reading a book at the moment called Clan of the Cave Bear. And if you haven't read it, you should read it. It's fantastic. It's a wonderful story. And it's about a clan of what are not sort of explicitly called Neanderthal people, but that's pretty much what you think they are. They have tools like this, and they would have used them for things like I've done to remove the keratin from this tree buffalo, to expose the horn, because of course the human being and our ancestors became increasingly less physically imposing until they started to look a little bit like me at 5'8" and particularly unpresupposing physically. But of course, as we got smaller, our brains got bigger, and with our enlarged brains, as with our ape ancestors, of course, came the ability to use tools. And so what they would have done is probably made an anvil out of a skull like this, and then they would have chipped off bone with a probably slightly finer one like this, not chipped off bone, they would have chipped off the sinew And that could have, of course, been used for meat. I suppose you could have used that for meat if you wanted. Also, they would have chipped off the sinew like this to wind into twine, and that would have been used for things like bows and arrows and that sort of thing. And then, of course, a big heavy rock like this would have been used to crush open the bone. But to crush open a bone like this, you probably have to have something slightly harder than that even. And of course that is where the marrow is, and if you are a hungry Neanderthal, nothing like a good piece of marrow for your breakfast. Now, we have been playing the game Two Truths and One Lie. Now, Brent, of course, very cunningly didn't show you his face while telling you his lie. So we don't know if he's in fact, well, of course, you would have been able to tell if you were a member of the FBI, perhaps, whether he'd been lying or not, unless he's a psychopath. We're pretty sure he isn't. So you would have been able to tell. Now, I'm going to tell you three things, one of which is a lie, and it's my little sort of three are called, how well do you know Safari Live? The first one is, now watch my eyes carefully, everybody. Brent and Jamie are engaged to be married and live in Hoedspruit. Jean-André has the haircut of a clown and used to work in the circus. Number three. Taylor McCurdy comes from the forgettable town of Port Elizabeth. Hashtag Safari Live, tell us which one you think is correct. We will do a Twitter poll and come back to you with which one was a lie and which two were the truth. Now, there's a poll on Twitter. I have absolutely no idea how that works. Anyway, you'll figure it out. You can vote fact one, fact two, fact three. So fact one, Brent and Jamie are engaged to be married and live in Hoedspruit. Fact two, Jean-André was a clown in the circus. And fact three, Taylor McCurdy comes from the deeply regrettable part of the country called Port Elizabeth. Good. Oh, Jenny, now you've brought up a subject that is very trying for me to talk about. You said, when is Ronald the Rover coming back? Well, on the positive side, the Russian is returned to us, thankfully, and he is the only one capable of fixing Ronald the Rover, and he is currently fixing Ronald as we speak. The sadness, of course, is that Ronald was not available to us today, but hopefully during the course of the week, he will be. We are, of course, doing a TV show on Thursday from 4 to 6 in the evening, Central African time, so the last hour of the show won't be there. You can watch it on the internet like you normally do. And Ronald will hopefully be up and running for that show. Marvellous. Good. Okay, let's go back inside the tent. Ah, Shamrock. Yes, absolutely. We can look at different skulls together. You want to see how they... Look, it's going to be difficult to see how they evolve together. And I'm interested just where your question comes from. Because I think a lot of the time we're kind of under the impression that we evolved from chimpanzees, which of course is not the case. We did not evolve from chimpanzees. Chimpanzees are as modern as we are. Well, in fact, they're probably a little bit older than we are. But we share a common ancestor. So if we look at the primate skulls that we have here, which I think is quite interesting. I'd quite like to have a human skull in here, but I just think that some people might be quite offended by that. Yes, I imagine it would cause great consternation. So if we look at these two skulls here, they are, of course, the baboons and the monkeys. And they are very similar in many ways, but as you approach humanity, which the monkey is slightly closer than the baboon, in other words, we probably shared a common ancestor with the monkey more recently than we did one with the baboon. We all eventually shared a common ancestor. What you will see is that the monkey's brain is proportionately much larger than the baboon's. You see that? Now, I need to do a little bit of reading up, of course, on the different parts of the brain. But what you have here is a vastly increased back region. And I think, if I'm not mistaken, there's a large amygdala, which I think is responsible for emotional responses. And then I think there's also a much larger frontal cortex. Now, if I'm not mistaken again, and Judy H., you will probably be able to bear me out or tell me I'm talking nonsense, the frontal cortex, as far as I'm aware, is responsible for our ability to think forward and to plan and that sort of thing. And so you will see, although a monkey's is nothing like as large as a human's, maybe Gendre's, it is probably able to adapt more readily than something like a baboon can. I mean, I am speaking slightly, I'm guessing here, but that's pretty much what I think is going on here. So the closer you get to the human being, of course, the larger the brain is and the greater the volume of the brain in relation to the size of the body. Our brains, interestingly, are around about, I think, 1,200 to 1,400 cubic meters. Cubic centimeters, not cubic meters at all. And I'm not going to try and work that out in inches. In a Neanderthal, Neanderthal's skull was bigger than ours. Neanderthal had a bigger brain than the human being, and I always think that just leaves a tantalizing thought as to what happened to them. If their brain was so big, why did we outlive them? What happened to them? Was it us that got rid of them? And how clever actually were they? Did they have language? Were they able to speak? We don't really know. It's a wonderful sort of consideration to think about. Of course, around here, because there isn't an enormous amount of fossilization, because it's very ancient and the conditions don't allow for fossilization here so much, we don't have any clue as to what ancient hominids used to wander around this area. Yes, around, of course, we know around about Johannesburg, the Sterkfontein Caves, there are all sorts of hominid ancestors, and the most, the latest one, Homo naledi, was found there, one of our ancient human ancestors, somewhere around Johannesburg. Who was around here? Who made that hand axe? It could have been somebody as recently as 100 years ago. It could have been someone in the way distant past, more than maybe 100,000 years ago. Isn't it fascinating to think about? Good, let's put these back. Gendre, you're about to be attacked. Now, I'm obviously not very good at this game. Either my facts are too obvious or, you know, I've got a very obvious tell. But 15% of you said that fact one was inaccurate, that Brent and Jamie are engaged to be married. No, I'm afraid that is true. They are. 70% of you got it correct that Gendre didn't used to work for the circus. Brian used to work for the circus, and that is the truth. Gendre still looks like a clown, though, so one of them was relatively true. And, of course, the third one, 17% of you said wasn't true, that Taylor does come from the regrettable part of the world called Port Elizabeth. One part of that was true. Taylor is from Port Elizabeth. In fact, both parts were true. Port Elizabeth is indeed regrettable. Now, let's head straight across to, I think we're going to Steph, who seems to have something that used to be used as an LP needle.
Thank you, James. Trees go to such massive lengths to protect their leaves, which of course are valuable to them because they make food from sunlight, but also they're valuable to animals. And none other than this acacia tree. This is one of the acacias, I think it's the Brackthorn acacia, and has such splendid thorns. I just want to show you how long these thorns actually are by taking one of them off. A thorn, unlike a spine, is a modified leaf. A spine is a modified branch, a thorn is a modified leaf, and just have a look at this guy. Designed totally so that the animals coming to eat get poked in the face, but that is easily longer than my hand. Have a look at that, incredible, hey? So these thorns, the tree uses some of its energy to produce these thorns, which do not photosynthesize, they don't contain chlorophyll. Some of them do. Fever tree does definitely contain chlorophyll in its thorns, but not this tree. And what it's trying to do is dissuade animals from coming too close and putting their lips onto these leaves to peck it off. And you can see that the thorns do a fantastic job. It's sort of like an eternal arms race between these trees. Now, what's incredible is the fact that The acacia tree uses hardware, it uses thorns, whereas the tambwiti tree uses a bit of a chemical defense mechanism. Here's a tambwiti tree, and while the thorns will dissuade some predators, they won't dissuade all of them. And so then you have to resort to chemical defense. And you can see that the tambwiti leaf, no thorns or spines here, looks yummy until you pick it, and then that milky latex is present. And that milky latex is caustic, it burns, it creates blisters, it'll make you violently sick. And so this tree can quite easily use all of its leaf surface to make food rather than the acacia. So there's your two defense mechanisms. Chemical defense, and then I suppose you'd call it, but ordnance. What would you call it? Spikes. Alright. And on that note, we're going to send you over to Brent with those leopard.
Now, isn't that look? Doesn't that look like the best way to spend a cold, overcast Sunday afternoon? Curled up in a tiny little ball, as snug as a bug in a rug. Now, of course, we're hoping that Mom comes back soon, and she'll lead them back to a kill, and hopefully we also get a sight of young Hosana, who's probably hiding around here somewhere. But little Shongile is curled into a cute little ball of fluff at the moment, looking very, very content. I keep glancing around, but if young Hosana is lying in a little divot or dip or behind a branch or tree, it's going to be really unlikely that we can see him. I'm very confident he's in this area somewhere, but where exactly? As you can see, it's quite a thick area. Look at that, very thick. So hopefully he is around. I'm pretty sure he is, and hopefully our patience will game will win this evening, and Mom will come back and collect both the cubs. Oh, no, she hasn't moved an inch. And you can see it's getting darker now. Some relatively big clouds moving in from the south. So even though she's fast asleep, just watch her ears carefully. Every now and then they might move if there's a little bit of noise. And you can see there's a tiny little breeze blowing that hair in her ear. Now you can see how still she is. Now we saw that tiny baby Inyala lying in a very similar little ball in the Mowati River. When was that now? Yesterday or day before. Now this is the same principle. If she's very still sleeping like that, it's very unlikely that a lion or hyena will spot her. If they're just walking past, she will just look like part of the termite mound. We must remember that a lot of the animals out here, their eyes don't work the same way eyes do, so they don't see in detail, and they see in sort of various shades of grey, and their eyes are designed to pick up movement. So if you're being still, it doesn't elicit that instinctive chase response. Now, I know it sounds counterintuitive, but when you're walking in the African bush, the most important rule is whatever you do, don't run. And that's even when you're being charged by something as big as an elephant. Okay, so we're going to sit here, continue to play the patience game. This is live, so we can't predict what's going to happen next. But while we do that, Jamie has got the other big cats of Juma to show you.
And I second that, which is why it's always a very, very good reason to sit patiently and wait for the action to start. And just bear with me one moment. I was right in the middle of a conversation, so just hold on 1 second. With on the Game Drive channel, it's the way in which we communicate amongst guides to share information, and Lex was trying to get hold of me. Copy that. Thanks very much, Lex. I've got a lioness that's parked herself basically under my wheels, so I'm not going anywhere just yet. It's a negative. I'm still with the rest of the bride. Lex had called me because I did ask the other guides earlier if they could let me know if there were any elephants about. He has found some elephants not too far away from where we are. Fortunately, the lions are so incredibly comfortable with our presence that the second female has plopped herself down there, which is my only way in or out of this particular spot. I can't really go forwards because I'm going to go tumbling down a hill, and obviously I can't go backwards because there's a lioness there. Right there. Starting up the engine at this point might give her a little bit of a shock. So rather than do that, we're just going to sit patiently, aren't we, Brian? We're just going to wait. Perhaps the elephants will come to us. Hello, gorgeous. Lions were showing signs of stirring, but they seem to have decided against it. As we sit with 7 out of 8 in Kahuma cubs, that's your tail, little one, you silly thing. Cindy, you wanted to know if the lionesses realized that they have a missing cub. Well, that was a matter for much debate when the 2 went missing a couple of weeks ago and only turned up after about 3 or so days. Cindy, we won't ever know for absolute sure exactly what is going on in the minds of the lionesses. Personally, I think that when they have a number of cubs to keep track of, I don't necessarily think that they realize they're missing 1 or 2. Certainly the whole lot, absolutely, they'll know that there's no cubs with them. But when it's 1 or 2 out of 8, I don't think lionesses can count, and I'm not 100% sure that they realize that they've missed one. But I'm not 100% sure on that, and I think that the older the cubs get, the more they will become an integral aspect or an integral part of the pride. So there are people that disagree with me, and I honestly can't say whether or not I'm correct on this. The reason I say that they don't seem to realize is that they don't seem to be concerned at all. They don't seem to call, they don't seem to be looking, they're perfectly relaxed and content, and we can't, on a cold day like today, they could easily be moving around and looking for a missing cub, and they aren't. And it makes me think, it's not that they don't care, I just don't think that they realize. It's an entirely different story when a lioness is denning, and she's got 3 little cubs, for example, and then if one of them were to go missing then I think that they would realize. But I don't know, and I'd be very eager to hear what James said. However, he has taken my words to heart and has been watching closely to the Juma Dam camera. Let's go and have a look and see what he has found there.
Oh, we're just going to quickly look up there, everybody. There's a Lavalliance cuckoo, and they're having a major fight outside here. That's not really why we brought you here, though. The Zumi very, very cleverly found a lion at the dam cam. So we'll go there right now. There's the lioness moving now. Well done, Zumi. You're doing an excellent job of keeping up with that lioness. And I was hoping that there might be a cub with the lioness, but there doesn't seem to be. She seems to be on her own. Now, as far as I'm aware, Jamie's got 3 with her. This one is now going north up Mvubu Road, straight towards the rest of those lions. Where the other lioness is, I don't know. Quite possibly mating with one of the Birmingham boys. Perhaps this one is returning from a failed hunt. Oh, Jamie's only got 2 lionesses, so perhaps this one went for a drink in a puddle somewhere. That's well possible. Now, for those of you who do keep an eye on the dam cam, can we ask Mr. Zumi, whoever you are right now, to zoom all the way out, if you don't mind, or once you've lost sight of the lion. And I just want to show you something, because many of you, of course, keep an eye on the dam cam, and it's wonderful stuff, and it's great you give us information in the mornings, especially when we go out, and it's lovely to know what was seen. That lioness is heading north up Mvubu Road. So sometimes it's very difficult to tell exactly what's going on and where the lions are and what direction they're moving. So she's moving up north up Mvubu Road. If she was to turn 90 degrees to the right-hand side, she would be going due east. And if she was walking straight towards the camera now, she'd be walking pretty much due west. There she goes. That's really wonderfully done. Well done, Zumi. In fact, you can see that's one of the mothers, can't you? You can see that she's still got very swollen teats. And then if she had been going the opposite direction, of course, she would be heading due south. So that's quite a nice way of showing it, because I think it sometimes can get a little bit confusing, especially if there's no sun. It's quite difficult to tell where on earth those lions are and what they're doing. So that was marvellous stuff. Wasn't that great? Nice to see a lion from the dam cam. Of course, Ronald the Rover met a lion the other day, and they were quite interested in him. The male gave him a bit of a swat. Unfortunately, Ronald's battery died at that stage, and I was unable to take revenge on the lion by giving it a fright. Anyway, that's just the way it turns out. So that was the Lavalliance cuckoo that we were seeing out there. You probably heard them making a huge amount of noise. They're displaying now, and of course the females will be choosing a mate just before they go off and park themselves in probably a babbler's nest. That's what the Lavalliance cuckoo likes to parasitize. So she'll lay her eggs in a babbler's nest. They'll kick, well, I think they actually don't kick the babbler's eggs out. I think they're just raised by the flock with the babbler chicks. And I've always found it absolutely hilarious, especially in winter, because often the Lavalliance cuckoo doesn't migrate in the first year of its life. And in wintertime, you can find these flocks of babblers, which are about, oh, they're about that big, I guess. And the Lavalliance cuckoo, when it's adult, is about that big. And it is hilarious to watch the cuckoo living with a flock of babblers flying around as if it's one of the flock. The flock has no idea that this idiot isn't part of what they are, and the idiot doesn't have any idea itself. And the next year, when it eventually migrates, no one tells it where to go, no one shows it where to go, it just knows. How? No one really knows. It's somehow embedded in the genetic code, and how they know where to go, those cuckoos, is quite astounding, because of course they're never raised by their genetic parents, which I think is fantastic. Right, Brent is still with the leopard. It looks like the head is up, so there's high action at the leopard sighting. Let's go and find out what's going on.
Well, it depends on your definition of high action. She has raised her head slightly. She is looking down towards the beginnings of a little river system, and that's where her brother might be hiding. If her mom was coming back in here, we would hear her calling, ow, ow, something similar to that, and chuffing. Chuffing is a puffing up of cheeks and all sort of that is unique to leopards and tigers. There are only two that seem to communicate like that. Now, while she's staring there and you're looking at her, I'm just picking up my binoculars and just have a quick closer look at that area she's looking in. Well, she, you never know, she might have seen a lizard or a frog or a bird. And I can't see anything just yet, but at least she's not wound in a tight ball, so she might go on a little wander around as she did when we found her at the beginning of this safari. Now, even though the females will leave them in an area, they will wander at this age up to 200 meters, 300 meters from where they were left, but generally will make their way back to quite close to where mom left them previously. Look at that face, it is just too gorgeous. Her eyes have become lighter the older she's got. She started off with very brown eyes. You can see they're sort of a little bit more greenish now, sort of goldy green. You can see quite a short face like her mom, not a long muzzle. Now, we suspect that Tingana is the most likely father to these cubs, but it is impossible to actually be 100% accurate unless you get the genetics. A female leopard will mate with a multiple males while she's in estrus, and any male she might come into contact with, even moving up to 4 territories out of her natal territory. And that's to ensure that all the boys think that they're the father. Because if a male leopard comes across cubs of a female that he hasn't mated with, he will kill them. And again, in killing the cubs, it immediately brings the female into estrus. Look at that. So we're discussing how cats see, and well, big cats in particular, like these ones we're sitting next to, and Mary's wondering, do they see in color or black and white? Oh, in black and white, but it's not true black and white, it's more shades of gray, Mary. But they don't see color, and they don't see detail like we do. Their eyes are designed to pick up on movements. Most primates can see in, oh, look at that long stretch. Oh, but it looks like she's still going to be sitting there, and it sounds like there's some excitement happening with the lion, so let's go have a look.
A herd of impala has just stumbled through into the sighting. Oh, they've just realized. I was wondering when that was going to happen. Sorry to rush you across, but we just couldn't run the risk of missing out on a lion hunt, and she'd gone completely flat behind our vehicle. We couldn't reposition in any way. Now, an impala is not exactly a boon for these lions at the moment, but they are never one to pass up the opportunity for a quick meal. An impala would be gone in the blink of an eye if they had happened to catch one. But unfortunately for them, they just weren't quite quick enough off the mark, and there wasn't quite enough cover for them to have managed to approach in that way. And they were perfectly, perfectly downwind of those impalas, so there's no way that the impala would have even realized. If they hadn't seen them, there was no way they would have smelt the presence of the lions. So there was a moment there where we were all frozen in expectation. Sorry, just bear with me one second. Standing by. Yes, have you caught on, madam? She didn't even realize. Ah, oh, sorry, please go again with that. Are you welcome to make your way in? I think that's what he was asking me. And she was fast asleep. She had no idea those impala were there until they ran away. They have now vanished off into the distance, and we find ourselves once again with a relatively peaceful lion sighting. And that's the joy of life, of course, is that we don't know which direction things are going to take. We just have to stop and wait for them to take their, to unfold in the way that they do. And for now, the lion cubs could not be more bothered. Their mothers will, however, as it does start to get darker, they are going to get up and start hunting. I've noticed a few of the cubs are already looking like they could use a meal, despite the fact that their moms caught them a buffalo. What was that? Lioness up and looking. Now, the lioness that you saw on the dam camera with James, she is on her way towards us as we speak. So she might actually encounter that impala herd herself, and possibly even potentially chase it back in this direction. Now it's just a sit and wait game as the lions reunite once again. I haven't seen her returning to us. So we just have to wait our turn. Well, since all is calm down here and there's no sign of an impending impala kill, let's go across to Steph to find out what he's been up to on foot.
We just sat here to listen to the call of a Jacobin cuckoo that's happening in the distance. And as my old friend used to say, Mr. Richard Ndubani, said, that means that there's a 70% chance of rain tonight, and so that's what we're going to bet on for tonight, 70% chance of rain. But it's also given us a chance to play.
Whoa, welcome back. It's just really exciting. And I know I've been saying that young Hosanna is right here. And he's just made an appearance. He gave all of us, including Shongile, a fright. He jumped onto her and went, whoa, and we weren't looking. There he is. You can see how big he's getting. Hello, mister. You look very impressed with yourself. You managed to give everyone a fright. You can see how much bigger he is. Yes, you are. Wow, he's grown so much since I last saw him. Now, no sign of mom, just the kids. So he's been lurking about here the whole day, but he's decided to grace us with his presence. I heard a Franklin alarm calling a little earlier, and I assumed that it might have spotted him because Shongile was fast asleep, as she was when he jumped on her. Here we go, waiting patiently for mom. Now, we might get some playing. They're listening to the Franklins. And they could even maybe go stalk Franklins. That is a young leopard while mom's away. One of their favorite pastimes, stalking. Causing great fear in all the local bird life. Oh, look at that face. Look at his ears pointing directly towards where the Franklins are calling. Hello, Gigi. Gigi wants to know, how old are these cubs? Oh, there's a big yawn. Oh, yes, there we go. Gigi, they are just over 9 months old now. I think 9 months. What month are we in now? November. They were born in February, on the 2nd of February. Now, quite often you sort of guess when a leopard cub is born, but we were lucky enough to see them when they were a few hours old. We noticed their mother acting quite strangely the evening before, and she was heavily pregnant, and she went into a little cave on the riverbank, and we went there the next morning, and these two absolute bundles of joy were not much bigger than my hand at that stage. Yeah, you, look how big you are now. Oh, you're going to be full of mischief. Are you going to leap on your sister? No leaping, no harassing. Oh, maybe he's growing up. Probably not there. Let's try and move to the other side of the termite mound. A really big safari live. Welcome to Ventile in Canada. Who's a new viewer and said this looks really interesting and cool? It is very cool. And Ventile would like to know, when do leopards normally go out to hunt? Well, Ventile, it all depends. So mostly it's from the late afternoon into the night, but some leopards do hunt during the day. Their mother is quite famous for hunting during the day. Oh, he's come back. Of course he's come back as we move around, keeping us on our toes. Now, it also depends on where you are, Ventile. So in areas where leopards face persecution from people, they almost hunt exclusively at night. But in an area like this, where they have massive protection and are able to live their lives without any persecution from people, they will hunt during the day as well. Generally, cooler days. Now, The reason for this is that, like most big cats, they have a problem dispelling heat. Oh, big yawn. Been sleeping all day, now he wants to play. Where's Mom with my dinner? But, as we're saying, they are opportunists, so like most of the wild animals out here, if something happens upon them, whether it be day or night, rain or sunshine, they will take that opportunity to get a meal. Even if they've caught something already, they will store it, stock it, and eat it a little later. Now, most animals out here have no problem eating rotting flesh, and leopards included. Where are you off to now, mister? Are you coming to come have a look at us? Or is he off to go stalk the Franklins? Now, for those of you wondering, and are new, a Franklin is a bird, like almost like a partridge. So he's gone right behind the car. I'm just trying to see where we go. VM's going to swing around where he's off to. There is a little pan close by. He might go for a drink. We'll just keep an eye on where he's off to. Oh, he's coming to... What are you up to, mister? Oh, he's found something that smells interesting in that bush. Look at those eyes. And sister's just snoozing still, back in her tight little ball, so we're going to stick with him. And hopefully he moves out of that thicket shortly. Oh dear, I think I've been naughty. Yes, I have. I've pulled my earpiece out. There we go, it's back in now. There he is. Look at that, beautiful. Now, Savari Dean's wondering, do leopards avoid mange because they don't eat buffaloes? No, a mange doesn't come from buffaloes. Mange is generally picked up from the sand. It's a mite that lives in the soil. And so it's not about what they eat. And I actually have seen quite a few leopards in the Southern Sabi Sands that have developed mange as well. So it's not exclusive to lions, and I mean anything with fur can get mange. Impala, wildebeest, zebra, giraffe, lion, leopard, hyena. So it's not exclusive to animals that eat buffalo. And actually probably more common in the herbivore species. Well, let's go see. I think he might be going for a drink, so let's follow him. Sister still fast asleep, not even moving. He's going quite quickly. Don't worry, we'll get there. Oh, we had a duck. Under the bushes. Now, this is one of the incredible things about being in a private area like this. And in these private areas, we are able to off-road. Now, the reason being that you can't generally off-road in a national park is because any of your member of the public can go there. Now, let's see, where did he go? Might be on the other side of this termite mound. Is he? Here he is. Hello, monster. Look at that. What are you doing in the... Having a good old time. So, saying about off-roading. So, of course, everyone here who drives the vehicles has got lots of experience in the bush. So, we know which trees it's safe to drive over. Oh, he's stalking doves that have come down to the mud's edge. That's what he's doing. Or he is now. I think the dove caught on to him, though. Yeah, dove's a bit quick for you, Mr. Hosanna. So it seems like while his sister was snoozing, he's been meandering around, terrorizing the local bird population. What are you going to terrorize next? He seems to be searching for something to chase. So we're going to stick with him. Hopefully he finds something else to terrorize shortly. But while we do that, let's go see what incredible vista Jamie has.
And what a truly incredible vista it is. Just look at the beauty of this almost full moon. Full moon's tomorrow, isn't it, Brian?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, we're not quite there. We're still at the waxing gibbous stage. I'm going to let you take a moment to take in the beautiful vista, as Brent described it, whilst I answer poor Mike, who has been trying to get hold of me on the Game Drive channel. Standing by, Mike. Copy that, no problem, Mike. If you take the 2-track that leads to the old hyena den off Mvubu Road, you'll find us there. You just follow the 2-track as if you're going to the hyena den. And there we go. Just helping Mike, sorry about that, everybody. I know he is very close to us, which is why it was relatively urgent that I help him out in terms of tracking us down. Is close. I'm just helping him find exactly where these lines are. So while you were with Brent and the magical prince and princess, we have the arrival of the third lioness, who had gone to obviously go and have a drink or perhaps scout out and see whether there were any potential hunting opportunities. But all three are reunited once again, for which two cubs in particular seem to be rather thankful as they settle down and tuck into the evening meal. And scenes like this might not be described as overly exciting or action-packed, but they are a moment to just really, truly enjoy the beauty of an evening like this evening. From the view of the moon that we just had, to these suckling, contented cubs. And one always tolerant mom. Oh, big stretch. All cats and dogs have the ability to stretch like that. What you found? Nothing terribly exciting. I have a feeling that these lions are not going to be moving off just yet. Now let's go to James, who of course has the amazing capacity to give you a really close-up view of some very interesting things.
The most amazing thing I wanted to talk about now, excuse me, first of all, was the fact that the Nkuhuma's cub's hip is showing there, and I find that strange because they eat so much, so I don't really know why that should be the case. The second thing is to say that yesterday I met a guest who was staying at Arethusa, and that guest said to me that they had just watched Shongile, yes, the very same, killing a squirrel and eating it. So she has officially made her very first kill. So that's quite a nice thing to know. I didn't tell anybody so that I could save it for a tent fact, everyone. Now, let's have a look down here at the microscope. There is a gorgeous beetle. Now, the fossicker-in-chief found this on something called a sandpaper raisin. Now, the sandpaper raisin is obviously, given its sandpapery quality, you can see by those very fine star-shaped hairs that are on the surface of the leaf. And I said to the fossicker-in-chief, I said to her, "Where, what kind of a beetle is this, fossicker-in-chief, pray tell?" And the fossicker-in-chief said to me, "I don't know what kind it is." So I said, "Seek ye the beetle in a book." because I am sure that I hast seen it there before. And the Fossicker-in-Chief then didst open the book, look inside it, and come back to me and say, I still do not know what is thy beetle. So we don't know what it is, everyone. I do apologize for that really horrendous performance. But it is very beautiful, nevertheless, and it lives on the sandpaper raisin, which I think is rather marvelous. Beautiful. Good. Excellent. Now, we had one other thing to show you, and that was a leaf full of eggs. Now, let me very carefully get it out, because, of course, one must move with great stealth and care. Is there enough light on that, Jean-André? Can you see? No, you can't, because my finger's in the way. That's very irritating. There it is, everybody. Those are eggs. Isn't that amazing? Like little rubies. Very round rubies. Now, we're going to put them under the microscope. And what you'll see is that they have hatched. What we do not want to see is my nail. There we go. Look at that. You can see they've hatched. How fantastic is that? Now, we think that they could well be little caterpillars that have grown into bigger caterpillars, like that blue one that we saw earlier. And we confirmed, both Taylor and I, that they are from the Charaxes butterflies. And once you come back to me, which will be very shortly indeed, I will show you some Charaxes. There are all the Charaxes butterflies. They're these beautiful things. They're also called emperors. And the Bushveld Emperor is probably the most common one that we find down here. That's him there. Isn't he gorgeous? So that's what those gorgeous caterpillars are going to produce, which I just think is marvellous. Now, Brent Leo Smith is still with that marvellous male leopard. Let's go and take a look at it.
So he's up to all sorts of shenanigans. He's stalking around. He's terrorising the local bird population. And the drongos are quite upset with him, but that's not going to stop him. He's looking for all sorts of little creatures. He's hoping to find something he can pounce upon. So this is what I talked about earlier. There we go, he's just pounced on something. About them honing their skills. More than likely, he was trying to pounce on a grasshopper or some other poor little unexpecting insect. But he missed, otherwise he'd be looking a little bit more impressed with himself. I'm just going to try and get us in a slightly better spot. Now, we're quite lucky. So normally, at about this time of the day, as it gets a bit darker, we normally have to leave leopard cubs under a year old. But due to our new equipment and having, oh, there he comes, and having infrared, we are able to stay much longer with these incredible animals. Now it looks like he's going to be making a beeline back for his sister. He's probably still asleep atop the termite mound. Okay, let's move. Get into position to see them reunite again. Well, as we've just seen that little pounce and movement and all the stalking, Alice in Ohio is wondering, who do I think is the better hunter, Shungile or Hosanna? Just give me 1 second, Alice. I want to make sure we get there if he goes to jump on his sister. And Alice, I would say it's probably much of a muchness. I'd say they're probably equal in their skill at this age. Now, he's looking under the logs and everything. Now, then if we look up on that termite mound, look at that. She is watching him. She's not going to be caught unawares again. She might even start stalking him. Here we go. So, there we go. She's going to try and leap upon her brother. Look at that. Oh, look at that. See how the ears are flat? I'm quite sure he's aware that she's there, though. This is probably a game that these two have played for hours upon hours. Oh, I can't see where he is, but he's below her somewhere. We can't see him. There we go. There she goes. So he's there. Where we can't see. Let me just move again. I'm trying to see where it's going to be the best spot. It's just a little difficult area. I'm going to see if we can peek across from this log, or we can... I know, it's going to be better to go around. One unfortunately large tree, fallen tree in the way. And you can see how relaxed these little cubs are in our presence. They carry on as if we weren't even here. Some tender moments between siblings. Now, the one thing you'll notice, which is a very different comparison from the lion cubs, because the lion cubs are almost always in attendance with other lions and that, and the solitary cats, even when they're playing. Unless mom's around, they're very quiet. That's a guilty look on his face. Waiting patiently for mom to return. Hi, cat in Tampa. Cat is wondering, do they still have their baby teeth? I would say not, cat. They would have lost those at about 6 months old. So they're on their big teeth. All their big teeth are growing through now.
Railing, railing, railing.
My mic switched off.
Oh. I think it's... there we go. How's that? I think I sat on it. Isn't this just wonderful? We're able to spend these incredible, intimate moments with these cats as they grow up. Now, wouldn't it just be wonderful if Mom arrived now as well? There would be much excitement. And remember I said when we were sitting with that little leopard fluff ball curled on top of the termite mound doing absolutely nothing, I said, patience is key. And often the best sightings you ever see come if you are patient. Now, Megan was wondering what happens if their mom doesn't come back. Well, if she doesn't come back tonight, they'll play for a bit and then they'll snooze again. Now remember, leopards probably sleep a little bit less than lions, probably 18 hours a day. Or rest and snooze for 18 hours a day. If mom didn't come back today, it wouldn't be unusual. Sometimes she'll leave them for 3 or 4 days. Especially at... Oh, did you hear that, Vim? I thought I heard a... Ow. But I think we would have got more reaction from them. I think it's my wishful thinking. So, but Megan, if she didn't come back indefinitely, would be a very interesting thing. They are probably old enough to survive. Cubs this young have survived after their mother have abandoned them. It is unusual, but it's not impossible. And generally, they would probably live a lot of insects and squirrels and dwarf mongoose and Franklin and small things. Until they were able to get big enough to graduate onto bigger animals. So we're going to sit here in hope that Queen Karula comes to lead them back to a carcass. Now, aren't we spoilt? Because from one set of big cats to another with Jamie.
And spoilt, I think, is definitely a very, very good way to describe exactly what it is we are. We just whipped you across to have one last view of the lions before we move off. As you can see, it is starting to get relatively dark, and we're going to start heading back towards the main camp. Uh-oh! What's wrong, Cup? What happened there? Shame. I think it got something in its foot. That was not very coordinated at all, was it? But yes, we are slowly but surely starting to run out of light, and for our newer viewers, what that means is that we cannot linger too much longer. We cannot spotlight a group of cubs of this age, so we don't want to impact their lives in any way, shape, or form, and adding the extra level of spotlight distraction at night just isn't fair on them. So we will be pulling out of the sighting in a moment, and we'll start trundling back towards James in the tent. Look at you. Then restless, even though they're flat, even though this lioness is lying on her side, you can always tell when lionesses or a group of lions is thinking about moving. The licking of the paws, nibbling away at the nails, just making sure that their feet are in good condition. And when they start to yawn as well, that's when you know that movement is imminent. And Zentile, there we go. That brings us to the answer to your question, which is, do lions sleep at night or do they hunt? It's very much, sorry, I heard whatever she heard, which I think was an elephant, actually, moving around in the vegetation behind us. It's very much dependent on the circumstances. So yes, for the most part, lions are nocturnal hunters. They are almost always, when they do hunt, it is almost always at night or on a cloudy day, and that's because they can't cope with hot temperatures of our daytimes here in Africa. However, they will, if they have a kill, they're quite content to, if it's a big kill, something like a buffalo or giraffe perhaps, they're quite happy to just nap away throughout the evening. But for the most part, they are nocturnal animals, and that is when they actually truly come into their own and truly become the apex predator of this area. And as I make my way out of the sighting, as it starts to get a little bit dark, we're going to start heading out. We're going to head across to Brent and his gorgeous leopard cubs.
Well, it seems like a lot of the playing slowed down a little bit. And obviously Queen Karula is out there somewhere trying to get them some dinner. Oh dear, and I nearly got whacked by an assassin bug, but it's gone now. Trying to climb into my boot, naughty assassin bug. But we are going to leave these leopards shortly and leave them to play. I don't think Mom's coming in there. Look at them, off they go in the next couple of minutes. And also, we don't want to bash and crash at night. If they're staying in one place, it's fine. But as you can see, they're going to be quite mobile now. And we don't want to accidentally attract any hyenas while we're moving. Now, that's the main reason we don't stay with leopard cubs after dark is that the hyenas are so smart, and there's been game drives in the Sabi Sands for so long that they've learnt that spotlights at night can sometimes mean leopard kills on the ground or something like that. So they actually learnt to follow spotlights to steal their kills. But we're not going to stay. We're going to go move on and move back towards camp, because it is getting dark, and hopefully, we're not going to get any rain while we're on drive, but hopefully overnight some more life-giving rain will fall here in the Sabi Sands. And also, you know, driving around in these areas in this part of the bush, you can break your car very easily. Now, I'm sure a lot of you are wondering how we identify the different individual types of leopards. And while my hands are busy, the artist extraordinaire, James Hedry, is going to draw you some spot patterns.
I think given how magnificent my art is, I should perhaps have a beret to wear in here. What do you think, Gendre? Yes, with a pan au chocolat and a small espresso next to me. Very nice on my easel. Now, what we have here is two drawings, which are very clearly obvious as to what they are. We have Shongile and Hosanna, obviously. Now, what I'm going to show you here is their spot patterns. Now, what's interesting is that I've noticed a different spot pattern on Shongile, and I don't know how many of you have as well. This Shongile has got her three spots, and she's got her beauty spot on the left, so that's four. And I used to think she was a three-spot leopard on that side, so I used to think she was a 4-3 leopardess. She isn't. She's got another one there. It's very tiny, like that, and another one just there. That's a mistake, the top one. So she's actually 4-5. That's what she is there. You can only see those if you look very carefully at her. So that's quite interesting. So we'd call her a 4-5 female. I'm sure those other two will get slightly bigger as she gets bigger. And he is a very clear, I think, 3-3. So that's quite nice. And, another great way, of course, of identifying them, Nicole, you've picked that up quite nicely, is by the necklace around their necks. They've all got a prominent necklace, correct? But it's all unique. Of course, all leopards have unique spots, but that the necklace and those spots around the nose are some of the more noticeable features, and it makes it easier for us to identify them. I'll quickly write Shongile for you here in my best, most glorious handwriting. Isn't it lovely? I was a calligrapher at one stage, Gendre. Do you believe me?
No.
Yes, that's a straight lie with no truth involved in it at all. And that's Hosanna. Yes, very nice. Okay. Now, Shongile, of course, as Brent said, means beautiful one or exquisite one or whatever it is, which I find it very interesting still that we have in 2016, we've named the girl beautiful and we've named the boy sort of chief. Big strong chief. Hosanna means chief, of course, and the ANA, Hosi, means chief, and Ana means very small. So Hosanna, small chief. Let's head across the dam cam where Henry is on the prowl for some dinner. There he is. You can see him in. Well, please excuse the picture. It's just what happens, I'm afraid, when it gets dark. And very cleverly, this camera that we have there is able to kind of suck the light out of the very last bits of darkness. And Henry is now eating himself some water vegetation, some weeds, and he'll go off and get some grass, I'm sure, a little bit later on. But already, because of that greenery, he's putting on condition. And so his fight with the lions of two nights ago, certainly much easier. At least last night, certainly much easier than it would have been 2 months ago when he'd had nothing to eat at all. So that's good old Henry there. Fine fellow that he is. I'm looking forward to the day that Ronald rejoins him. And of course, Ronald, everybody, for those of you who don't know, is a robot. He is a, well, unfortunately, he had an accident with the water. I drove him into the water by mistake. And actually, I didn't. He was kicked into the water by an elephant, and then I sank him in an attempt to get him out. It was a dreadfully painful time for all of us. Ronald is on the way to recovery. The Russian is fixing him, thankfully. Phew. Okay, let's have one last look at the microscope today. I wanted to show you something else that Taylor found, and that is the flower here, gorgeous flower of the sandpaper raisin on which we saw that bug that she couldn't identify. I, of course, knew exactly what it was. I just didn't want to tell her. Talking rubbish, I had no idea what it was. I still don't know what it was. She's been marvelous finding all these things for us. Look at this gorgeous thing. So that is the yellow flower, the sandpaper raisin. And for those of you who haven't been watching while we've been in the tent, it's quite a nice way to show the different male and female parts. So most of those things, let me try and hold it still. There is a bit of a wind, I'm afraid. The yellow bits, yellow and white and gold, those are the anthers. Those are the male parts of the plant. That's where the pollen sits. And then that green thing off to the bottom left, I'll just try and focus in on it a bit better. There it is. Look at that. Now, that's the style, and the style is basically a tube down which the pollen will go, and it'll go into the ovum, which is way down in the bottom of the plant there. And that is where, yes, I thought that was quite impressive too, Kirsten, thank you. What you'll find is that the ovum contains the eggs, and the eggs will be fertilized by the pollen, which will in turn form a little fruit. And on this particular plant, it's actually edible. It's not particularly delicious. Very little fruit out here is delicious, unless it is a marula fruit, which is exceptional. Right, let's head back to Jamie and find out how her darkness driving is going.
Driving around and just enjoying the peace of the evening. Just bumped into an elephant herd. One of them, I assume, I didn't see it as I came around the corner. There's the one shooting across the road in front of me. Hello, my girl. Do you mind if I come past? Hello, my girl. Okay. All right. I'll tell you what. I'll give you a little bit more room. Is shaking her head at us a little bit. For the most part, elephants are actually absolutely fine in the dark in the evening. I'm going this way, my girl. See? See? Here we go. Don't panic. It's okay. Uh-uh. No, 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 no. See? We're moving. Shame. She just got a little bit of a fright because of the position that she was in. She just felt a little bit cornered, which is why I went out of my way to go around her. Sorry, my girl. There she goes. She's relaxed again and feeding once again. Oh, yes, unfortunately, we can't. They are daytime animals, elephants, although they move around at night a lot. But for the most part, we try and avoid sitting and spending long periods of time with our lights on them. It's not like the other diurnal animals, the things like the antelope, where we can actually put them far more at risk of predation if we do shine spotlights on them by essentially taking away their ability to see in the dark for a while. But for elephants, that's not too much of a concern because it's highly unlikely that they are going to be attacked by anything. But even the lions out here don't have any reason to risk hunting elephants. In other parts of Africa, they do, and they do it relatively successfully. But with our elephants, the chances are incredibly slim. Either way, though, we don't want to sit and shine lights straight at them. We've left them alone for now. I said at the start of the sunset safari I wanted to find some elephants. Well, we succeeded. Unfortunately, it was just a slightly the wrong time. And that's the elephant, by the way, for those of you who were paying close attention to earlier when the lioness lifted up her head and I said I could hear elephants. It's those elephants. We've just come the long way around, and we're probably about 400 meters or so away from those lions. And those of you watching the dam camera, please keep an eye out after the end of the sunset safari. We are going to be, well, the lions are going to be trying to reunite once again with each other, the amber eyes and the young female together with that male, and then of course the rest of the Nkuhuma pride. So you might have that, and apparently there's a sound of a lion roaring moving slowly north along Twin Dams. So once we reach the end of our sunset safari, keep an eye out for the lions returning once again. I have no doubt that tonight is going to be the night for the predators. Karula hunting for her two cubs and for the lions hunting for theirs. This is the best possible kind of evening. Now, although it was full moon, that's going to be covered up by cloud. It's going to be windy. I think it might even be a little bit rainy as it starts to move further into the evening. And that, of course, is the best possible weather for a predator to hunt in. And that's exactly what they're going to be doing tonight. So hopefully, as Brent said, we have a start of a sunrise safari with a Karula going to fetch her cubs and take them to a kill, and the Nkuhumas with whatever it is they happen to catch. And I say it as though it's a certainty, because of course the Nkuhumas have been so unbelievably successful of late. Checking carefully every tree for a chameleon. And speaking of our climactic and geographic and all sorts of things, conditions, Deborah in Ohio, you say that you are so excited to see the full moon tomorrow. Me too, Deborah. I'm always excited to see the supermoons. I can't wait. Hopefully, because it rose at about 5:15 this evening, which means it should rise closer to 6 tomorrow. And that would be fantastic because it means that it'll be a little bit darker. It's going to be a truly spectacular, spectacular moonrise. So for those of you that join us, it would be wonderful if you could. And you can enjoy the incredible sunset safari moon. All right, let's head back across to Brent and find out where he is and what his plans are.
Taking one last gander at finding Queen Karula. Now, there's this massive cloud bank that's moving in, which is bad news if you're an impala, buffalo, or zebra, but great news if you're a lion or a leopard. So there's a good chance that both the Nkuhumas and Queen Karula are going to be successful. Oh, yay, yay, yay. Bush babies! They were moving as well, jumping from treetop to treetop. Hopefully we get there in time. Here we go. I think we're gonna make it. He jumped before we got here. Oh, there he jumped again. Okay, a little bit further forward. Here they are. Hello, little guy. Oh, he's caught something. Oh, no, he's just... Yeah, he's got a bug. He's got a beetle he's eating there. That must have been what he jumped for. How cool is that? Yum, 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 yum. Now, the bush babies are going to be overjoyed with the rain and all the insects that they bring. It makes foraging a lot easier. Oh dear, where's he gone? Oh, off he's gone. Can't see him anymore. He's gone into some thick stuff there. Wait, well, right, that was a nice little bush baby sighting, even though it was very quick. I see him munching upon a beetle. Oh, it looked like a beetle. Wonder what other nocturnal wonders await in the last few minutes of drive. And as I was saying, it's really good hunting weather tonight. There's a bit of a breeze, there's dark skies. Any ambient light from the moon is going to be darkened by the clouds. Now, it gives the lions and leopards a distinct advantage, especially if the wind picks up a bit more. So those Juma Cam aficionados, keep a listen out. You might hear the bellow of a buffalo overnight as the Nkuhumas prey on yet another one. Well, they did try a hippo last night, and I could hear that from home. So who knows what they might try eat tonight. Okay, I'm going to start slowly making our way back towards camp now. I wonder what else we're going to find. Now, we are going to be doing something a little bit different on this evening's sunset safari for the last 10 minutes, but I'm not going to tell you just what yet. It's a surprise. Now, we've had quite a few buffalo that have just keeled over from the drought and died, and Monique's wondering why haven't the Nkuhumas fed off any of those? Well, Monique, it's just been such a time of plenty. I think they've stumbled upon carcasses or made kills before finding those ones that have died of natural carcasses. Carcasses of natural causes. So I just think they just didn't happen upon them, and when they were there, they were sitting fat and happy on a buffalo of their own. Okay. Spotted several in this little grove of terminalias, and I know Jamie had a brief glimpse of one the other night, so fingers crossed. definitely one of the more beautiful little spotted cats. And it's always get that sort of dark and ominous feeling as these clouds roll in on a dark night. And I wouldn't want to be a buffalo tonight, put it that way, or an impala for that matter. And as you can see, I mean, I'm not seeing much general game. They're going to be keeping a very low profile in this windy, cold, dark weather. Now, as I said, we're going to be doing something a little bit different to end this Sunday safari. And for the last 10 minutes, we're all going to be together. But I'm not going to explain in depth too much. And as I said, it is a little bit of a surprise. Nope, I was hoping Karula, one last view at Karula. But alas, no sign, so I'm going to head back towards camp. And don't forget, we'll be doing this bright and early again for tomorrow's sunrise safari. But now, to explain what's going on for the rest of the safari, let me hand you over to the eloquent James Hendry.
Everyone, for the next 10 minutes or so, we're going to try and remain eloquent. One of us will remain elegant, I'm sure. Well, maybe two. But we have some sad news. And that sad news is that our very special friend, Gracie, aged 9, passed away, unfortunately, last Wednesday. And she fought a very long battle with cancer, and she's unfortunately gone off to join, well, whatever shore it is, in a greater light, hopefully, in peace and without any more pain. And so for the next few minutes, we're just going to pay a little tribute to her. She was a very special part of every single one of our lives. And then at the end of that, we'll have a little song. But before that, here are some of the highlights of Gracie's days on safari with us.
We have not been idle while you have been away from us, everybody. Oh, no. Now, during the Christmas period, I was drawn and sent a very kind picture by Gracie, aged 8, in Ohio. And Gracie, of course, received a Safari Barbie for Christmas. Jamie is a representative of Safari Barbie out here, of course. And she wanted, I think she made mention of a Safari Ken, if there is such a thing. And Gracie, I hope you're watching today, because while I was at Wiffleshoek Dam looking for animals, of which there were none, you'll be pleased to know that I found Safari Ken. There he is. You'll see that he has got two arms. He has two legs, he has hair. Wim said he looks a little bit like Donald Trump, but I think that's a bit unfair. Wim's contribution to Safari Ken was his hair. He has two eyes. One of them is about to pop out. He has a nose. Obviously a very smiley face because he's on safari. One hand, he's obviously right-handed. You can see the right arm is slightly stronger than the left arm. And he's probably been driving a car with his right hand out of the car. That's why that's darker than that one. And so this is Safari Ken, Gracie. I hope you like him.
It's there. There it is behind the mother. Is that it? Could it be? Oh, my goodness. Look, it's still fuzzy. It is. Oh, goodness. Look at its wobbly legs. Oh, I don't believe it. I can't believe we've actually seen it. Hi, baby.
Gracie, I have to tell you a secret. While I was watching that baby elephant, I was really, really hoping that you were able to watch this afternoon. Really hoping. So it's put a huge smile on my face to hear that 9-year-old Gracie, who is one of her favorite animals, is an elephant, that her heart is bursting with love for that little baby. And Gracie, you don't have to thank me. It's an absolute pleasure. I'm so glad that you could share it with us.
Hello, Gracie, age 9. You say, don't be in a yucky mood about this bird. Because it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You're absolutely right, Gracie. Especially not on your birthday. And I'm glad, I hope you've had a good birthday drive. I think we've had some wonderful things for you. Elephants and lions and lion cubs and Inkanyeni the leopard and fork-tailed drongos and a tawny eagle, not a Wahlberg's eagle.
Welcome, Gracie, and very, very happy to finally be having the tea party with you. I didn't bring the right muffins. We've got biscuits instead. They are very tasty biscuits. They're called tennis biscuits. And I don't know if you get them in America, but we love them here in South Africa. I did plan to bring some delicious vanilla muffins that I was going to put some of my homemade marula jam on. But it turns out that James and Brian found the muffins that I'd hidden in the fridge for you. I'd hidden them behind a watermelon, and James and Brian found them. But they didn't know that it was for our tea party, so we can't be angry with them. But it's quite funny that they ate our muffins, and they didn't know that they were ours. Because it's very hot today, Gracie, I've made a nice, cold, delicious chocolate milk drink. So I'm going to fill your glass up now. Very good. Look at how high we are. I don't know if you can hear it creaking. It's so good.
Now, what you can see from that clip, of course, is that Gracie brought us at least, if not more, joy than we ever gave her. So thank you very much for that, Gracie. And we're going to say cheers to you with your favorite chocolate milk, bottoms up. Now, each of us has got a little memory to share, and I'm going to hand over to Jamie to share hers.
I think one of my favorite memories of Gracie was when she asked us to ask Brian, who of course at one point was in an actual circus, to please tell the circus to send through some water so that the hippos could have some and the elephants could drink some. And I always felt it was unbelievably touching that no matter what she was going through, she had that incredible, yeah, selfless, caring nature. And as James said, she touched a lot of lives. Mm.
So unfortunately, Gracie, I didn't get to know you too well before you passed on, but I did find a poem that I'd like to read to you. And it's called God Saw You Getting Tired by Francis and Kathleen Kilo. God saw you getting tired, and a cure was not to be. So he wrapped his arms around you and whispered, come to me. With tearful eyes, we watched you, and we saw you pass away. And although we loved you dearly, we could not make you stay. A golden heart stopped beating when he gave you rest. God's garden must be beautiful. He only takes the best.
Very fitting. Now, I think my favorite Gracie story was the first baby wildebeest seen last year and it was right next to the Juma Pan, and we've been going through that incredible dry period, and so all the animals were really, especially the buffalo bulls, were just sitting in that pan, and the baby wildebeest got a bit confused and saw a big dark thing there, and so it went up to this buffalo bull, sort of thinking it might be another friendly animal or friendly wildebeest, and this buffalo bull headbutted it about 5 meters, and this thing was 6 hours old, and it just was sort of, luckily at that age, malleable bones, it sort of just bounced back up, didn't really know what was going, and Gracie came through, that buffalo needs a timeout. So that was my favorite, but yes, very, very, very special young lady, Gracie.
So what you can see is that none of us have a sad story to share at all about her, and I think every single one of us, every time the name came through on the microphone or on the earpiece, said Gracie, age 9, it was 8 for a long time, obviously, Gracie, age 9, would like to know something. My face used to light up. I've watched clips of Jamie's face lighting up. I've watched clips of Jamie, of Brent's and Taylor's faces lighting up, because the questions were clever. They were often comments born of great poignancy and of somebody with a huge amount of depth of empathy. And that's my sort of general memory of Gracie. And I know all the cameramen share in wishing her family and anybody who loved her, especially from Safari Live, of course, our best and most profound condolences. Now, obviously, I should sing her a little song, and I was going to sing a song, a Zulu song called Osiyeza, which means we are coming. And it's about the crossing that the Zulu people believe you make to the land of your ancestors when you die, and it's a very good song. But I thought it was a bit miserable for Gracie. And, of course, one of the great songs of Africa is that one, The Lion Sleeps Tonight. And I thought we'd do a new verse. And the new verse goes like this. You can all sing along. Oh, dear.
Don't you start.
Yeah, then we're all gone.
It's like this. It goes, I'll just say the words first and then I'll try and sing them without being a total fool about it. It goes, in the blue sky, the peaceful blue sky, a new star shines tonight. And anybody in the background there, perhaps Brian, you'd like to lend your voice to this. Just keep doing it again with another